A strawweight title defense headlines an action-packed night at historic Memorial Hall in Kansas City, Kansas for Invicta FC 47 as Emily Gordinha Ducote puts her 115-pound championship on the line against a newcomer to the division, Alesha Half-Pint Zappitella. Ducote's long, relentless pursuit of the belt finally came to fruition in spectacular fashion with her devastating knockout of Danielle Taylor at IFC 44. Now that she's risen to the highest spot amongst a crowded strawweight division, Ducote intends to stay there. Aiming to knock the champ off her perch is a newcomer to the strawweight class, former Atomweight champion, Alesha Half-Pint Zappitella. The diminutive but dangerous Zappitella is eager to prove that not only does she belong in the strawweight division, she's got what it takes to be the champion. In tonight's co-main event, we expect an explosive flyweight firefight when Courtney the Lion King squares off with Chelsea Chandler, who's looking to extend a three-fight winning streak. These fights and many more are headed your way next. From Memorial Hall in Kansas City, Kansas, this is Invicta FC 47, Ducote versus Zappitella. Just across the river from downtown Kansas City, Missouri, is downtown Kansas City, Kansas. Historic Memorial Hall is the site of Invicta FC 47 tonight. Ducote versus Zappitella. The strawweight championship of the world is on the line here this evening, highlighting seven big fights at Invicta FC 47. Welcome in, everybody. I am Nate Bucati. Thrilled to be with you here tonight for what should be a great night of Invicta FC action. Let me bring in Julie Kedzie here. And Julie, we've got some fighters who are going up in weight class. We've got some other fighters making their debuts tonight. All of them with something to prove.
Something to prove, indeed. There is something in the air tonight, Nate. I can't quite put my finger on it, but it smells like action. But I have to say, what they don't have to prove is their indomitable spirit, because this is Invicta FC.
You can smell that action, though, right now. Let me bring in the third member of our broadcast crew, Megan Anderson, and we're going to get to the headliner in just a moment. But the six fights leading up to it look really good as well. Which one stands out to you the most?
I mean, there's a couple that stands out to me. In the Atomweight division, I think the fight between Jillian DeCoursey and Lindsey VanZandt, title implications on the line, I think that's going to be a huge fight. But for me, obviously, as a featherweight, I have to go with Courtney King versus Chelsea Chandler. I love both of these ladies. They always bring it every time they step foot in the cage. That's going to be my pick of the night.
And then, of course, our main event, Ducote versus Zappitella for the strawweight championship of the world. Emily Ducote holds the belt after a stunning knockout of Danielle Taylor.
Yeah, Nate, you know, although Emily Ducote barely seemed to break a sweat when she captured the strawweight belt in Invicta 44 in a picture-perfect KO over Danielle Taylor, her road to the title has been anything but easy. Throughout her career, she has battled some of the best in the world in multiple weight classes, and in fact dropped her first attempt at the Invicta strawweight title to wrestling phenom Kanako Murata in a razor-thin split decision. But in knocking out Taylor, Ducote cemented her status as the champion she already knew herself to be, and she has no intention of letting that change tonight.
Okay, so looking to take the belt away from Ducote stands Alesha Zappitella. And Megan, she's a former Atomweight champ, but coming up in weight class with a title shot on the line.
That's right, Nate. And no change can be made without stepping outside of your comfort zone. And that is exactly what Zappitella is doing tonight. She's changed gyms. She's coming up a weight class. She's jumping right in the face of the champion. And she is looking to prove to everyone why she is one of the best in the world. She said her quality of life is so much better now at 115 pounds and believes that she is stronger and just as fast as this new weight class. She's expecting Ducote to bring the fight and is ready to put it all on the line and show the world.
All right, so it's a great slate of fights on tap tonight here at Memorial Hall. For more on the entire card, let's check in with the fourth member of our broadcast crew, Eve Edwards.
Thank you, Nate, and it's the Thug Jitsu Master here, and I'm excited to be back here at Invicta Fighting Championship with some of the best women in the world. That title fight is going to be exciting, but we have a lot of fights leading up to that, and let's get into them. The co-main event tonight is Chelsea Chandler. She's on a three-fight winning streak, and she's taking on the tough, always durable Courtney King. Then we have Jillian DeCoursey. She's due for a win tonight, facing off against the streaking Lindsey VanZandt. Two warriors are making the trip from Brazil to battle it out as Morandin takes on Pirosin. Then we have Serena, the southpaw outlaw DeJesus, as she takes on Brittney, the quiet storm Cloudy. Fatima Kline is making her Invicta return. She's taking on Sidney Trillo. And then we have opening the show, a young Jennifer Chieng, as she takes on Alyssa Lightning Linduska.
The challenger, Alesha Zappitella, making her way into Memorial Hall in Kansas City, Kansas, for Invicta FC 47. She's gonna take a shot at the Strawweight Championship tonight as she takes on the reigning champ, Emily Ducote. Fresh off a vicious knockout, she's putting that title on the line tonight. Invicta FC 47, coming up next from Memorial Hall in Kansas City, Kansas.
A new way is here. Free from the time-worn, the tried, and no longer true. Beyond the foregone conclusions of past limitations, a new way is here. The challenge is now defined for and by the people. The lessons are learned and turned upon the heads of those who cling to the way it was. Driven by the promise of strength, guided by the horizon of triumph. There is a new way. We feel it in our hearts, and we move it with our muscles.
Coming up next, we start things off in the strawweight division. Jennifer Chieng makes her return to Invicta FC as she welcomes Invicta debutante Alyssa Lightning Linduska. Tonight marks Chiang's first Invicta fight in almost 2 years when she fell to Helen Peralta via decision at IFC 42. That bout came as a last-minute switch and was fought at a catchweight. The former Olympic boxer believes that tonight's matchup will allow her to better showcase her skills.
I'm definitely looking to, you know, execute more techniques and to be a little bit more active and do more in this fight. I think we're pretty close in weight compared to the opponent that I had to face before.
Meanwhile, Alyssa Lightning Linduska makes her pro debut tonight after cruising to a 7-1 record at the amateur level. Going up against a strong boxer like Chiang, Linduska is looking to put her versatility on display tonight.
I think I have the advantage everywhere. I believe that I'm gonna go out there and I'm gonna do what I wanna do. I know how to transition from striking to the clinch to takedown to jiu-jitsu. I mean, I've been everywhere in a fight and I don't hold back. So I think I have the advantage anywhere.
Coming up next, it's Jennifer Chiang versus Alyssa Lightning Linduska. Debut is such a big moment in the career span of any fighter. Jules, Megan, what's going through the mind of Alyssa Linduska right now? She makes that cage walk for the first time as a pro.
Well, Nate, I made my pro debut in the Stone Age, so this might be better directed at Megan, but I will say a pro debut is an amazing experience, and given her actual well-rounded and incredibly lengthy amateur career, I think she's feeling pretty confident, actually.
Yeah, I mean, I am kind of similar to you, Julie. There wasn't really an amateur or a pro. You just kind of fought back when I first started. But, you know, like you said, Julie, the accolades that Linduska brings to the table, she is a phenomenal athlete, and I think she shouldn't be worried coming into her pro debut.
Megan, I know you told me watching her amateur fights, you were impressed with her fight IQ.
Yep. Oh, man, the decision-making processes that she makes during the fight are at such high level for somebody who's never had a pro fight. I'm very excited about this one.
Alyssa Lightning Linduska getting ready to make her pro debut in the strawweight division. Chieng getting ready to make her second ever fight in Invicta. She's got a tremendous boxing background, fought in the Olympics for Micronesia, Jules, and I know right now her opponent expects to see that boxing prowess on display here tonight.
She certainly does, but you know, Chieng is actually very well-rounded, and she's coming in here wanting to let us know what she is capable of. In her last fight, she took that fight against Helen Peralta. You know, Peralta was a last-minute opponent, cut a lot of weight, and did a very smart game plan of pinning Chieng, who has really good movement. And so Jennifer says she wants to show her hands, she wants to show her clinch, she wants to throw some elbows tonight.
Yeah, Megan, she believes this is going to be the type of fight that allows her to showcase her real skills a little bit more.
Yeah, and I think this is a perfect opportunity for her to do that. She's coming up against Linduska, who is also very well-rounded. I think both of them can really elevate each other and really showcase both their skills. But for Chieng, this is a huge opportunity to get a first win in the Invicta cage tonight.
Somebody's getting that first win tonight, whether it's Alyssa Lightning Linduska or Jennifer Chieng. All right, time now for our tale of the tape. Alyssa Linduska, the American, against Jennifer Chieng, fighting for Micronesia. 29 years old, Linduska, 5'4". She's got a slight reach advantage over the 36-year-old Chieng, who stands at 5'3". Let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, live from Memorial Hall here in Kansas City, Kansas, a very good evening and welcome to an exciting night of women's professional mixed martial arts for your enjoyment. This is Invicta FC. And now, ladies and gentlemen, we are set to go with three rounds of action, this in the strawweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, this mixed martial artist came in at 5'4" tall, weighing in officially 115 and a half pounds tonight. She makes her professional debut out of Forest Park, Illinois. Here is Alyssa Lightning Linduska. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner, a striker standing 5'3" tall. She too weighed in 115 and a half pounds and in two fights holds a record of one victory with one defeat. Fighting out of Brooklyn, New York, here is Jennifer Chieng. And your referee in charge of the action is Marcio La Selva.
First fight on the card tonight, Invicta FC 47, Linduska Chieng, and we are underway from Memorial Hall in KCK.
Bit of a feeling out period here between these two ladies. I think Linduska is looking to establish her jab. Big right hand by Chieng is really going to give her problems.
Yeah, I like how Linduska took the center of the cage immediately and she's staying up and down. But Chieng, that landed hard, that right hand. You can tell she put some respect on that one.
Yeah, and exactly, Julie. But I think what Linduska needs to do is her head is very center when she tries to enter that pocket. If she just, you know, brings her head off center line a little bit, that right hand, she's just going to slip and it's not going to be there. So I think if she just makes that small adjustment, she'll be fine.
Linduska said that she did a lot of mental work leading into this fight to not put too much pressure on herself making this pro debut. She tried in her last amateur fight to really approach it like it was a pro fight to get herself ready for this spot.
And that, I mean, yeah, nerves are everything. You can, they say it's not a real thing, it is a real thing. You can get that adrenaline down. But that extensive amateur career, again, very, very impressive. A really smart way of getting to the point of making your debut.
And she didn't shy away from tough competition. I think that's what's really going to help her as she transitioned to a professional, Jolie.
And I'm guessing Chieng's feeling fairly good that she's able to showcase some of that movement. Although that inside leg kick from Linduska is landing hard. And you can see she's going up to the liver several times.
And that's the perfect game plan against a classic boxer. They're very heavy on that lead leg. They're very, you know, lead leg dominant as they enter the pocket because they want to throw with a lot of power. And I think that's a really great game plan from Linduska to really attack that leg. And you look, we already see a little bit of swelling, a bit of redness on that lead leg of Chieng.
Absolutely, but I would say that that left kick also leaves you very susceptible to a very hard right hand if you're not cognizant and moving your head like you said earlier.
100%.
Halfway through round number one.
Well, I'm kind of wondering if Chang's feeling a liver shot right now. She seems to, she's breathing hard on that.
Well, I think Linduska is really mixing up those leggings, but she's starting to incorporate the left liver kick, which I think could be kind of, you know, giving Chieng some issues because that's going to stop that right hand. That's going to keep that right hand at home.
Well, Linduska told us she wanted to mix things up coming into this. She said she was birthed in MMA. She doesn't have one discipline that she really leans on more than another, and she thinks that versatility can be her strength. And now a flurry combination of punches from Linduska.
You can tell she's feeling, the shark smells the blood right there.
But one thing that's really smart is look how patient she is. She's not rushing in. She's not, you know, blitzing in. She's patient. She's picking a shot. She knows the moment will come when she's ready. And that is the marker of a high-level athlete.
Yeah, like you said, Megan, it's high-level. It's high fight IQ. Nice leg kick. Chieng's still active. I really like her movement. I'm scared of naked kicks. You throw a kick, that really kind of leaves you susceptible to those combos.
Linduska's really starting to put it together here. I think she seems to have found her range.
Yeah, but Chieng's teep right there was a very nice momentary range stopper. Up against the cage. This is where Chieng was held primarily in her Invicta debut. Linduska in there on the high crotch.
Under 1 minute remaining in round number one.
Linduska's doing a really good job of controlling the chin. As she's using her forehead there to really control the chin of Chieng, which is going to make it difficult for her to kind of turn the corner and get her back off the cage. But she's doing a good job of trying to switch her hips, you know. But Linduska's just right there. Beautiful, beautiful transitions.
Oh, lovely.
To ground they go.
You saw Chieng was defending the takedown, and quickly Linduska switched her hips over.
Final seconds of round number one.
This is a phenomenal, phenomenal ending for the round for Linduska.
That brings it close to round number one. And Megan, you told us before this fight that you really liked the fight IQ of Linduska. Did we see that on display in the first 5 minutes?
Oh, I think so. I think she for the first minute, maybe 90 seconds, she really, you know, she took a couple shots. She read her opponent. She read Jennifer Chieng. And now she's fighting her range. She's having a lot more success with the higher volume combinations. She's looking to, you know, fit in. And on her fit in, she's chaining her wrestling. She's looking that she just won herself that round. If she didn't do anything else with the striking, she won that round with that takedown. So that's a huge win in my book.
And we can see this right here. Chieng had that huge strike, and really Linduska felt her power, but some of those liver kicks were adding up. And you can see Linduska gets a little bit startled there. You know, she's feeling that power. She has great composure, and she goes in for that takedown attempt. Like you said, she chains it together, tips backwards over the hip. Just a really lovely read right there.
Just about set for round number two, Linduska versus Chieng. And they come out throwing punches right off the bat. Considering the boxing background of Chieng, are you guys a little surprised she hasn't been using that jab a little bit?
Big right hand.
Maybe we're seeing it now. Here they go to the ground once again.
And that's just smart. Look, Chieng knocked Linduska, not necessarily knocked her, but she shocked her a little bit. She hit her with a couple straight rights and really affected her. Smart decision, take it to the ground. She knows she has the advantage there, or she believes she has the advantage there. So why not take it to where you know you're comfortable and that you have the advantage?
And a lot of instinct too. There's a lot of instinct and composure going on there with that, because she was stunned from that right hand. It looked like it hurt. Now she's transitioned into mount. It's a good way to get your air back and also be in a place to really wreak some havoc.
And she's looking to get more of like a butterfly guard there, as lacing up the legs. She's doing a good job of putting Chieng's head up against the cage, which is going to be really hard for her to kind of do anything. Oh. Transitioning to the back. That was beautiful. She's got to be careful not to switch and lose position there. Chieng looks like she's almost out, but looks like Linduska is looking to switch to possibly a triangle if she can get that leg through.
And one of the things Chieng said about jiu-jitsu, you know, she does come from a boxing background, but she said she has a very deep appreciation for jiu-jitsu. Ooh, armbar attempt. And it's one of her favorite arts. You can see her defending against the legs. Looks to pass, but Linduska's knee is still in there. She's able to guard back up, or at least half guard back up.
You know, Chieng is sitting pretty high. I mean, if Linduska wanted to switch positions, she has a really good opportunity to deep half there and really, you know, kind of slide out the back and come and switch positions so she ends up on the back. But, you know, Chang's doing a really good job of controlling the head and preventing her from doing that.
2 minutes into round number two, this thing opened up with a flurry of punches, but then almost immediately went straight to the ground.
You can see them. I really appreciate pushing against the face, pushing against the mouth right there from the bottom from Linduska. She's not in a great position, but it is the cage that's actually kind of preventing the sweep from being full. So she's got to kind of transition back. It's going to be about her hip movement there. But she is effectively controlling Chieng's head, keeping her from mounting any sort of punching offense. Chieng is on top, though, and she is looking to advance her position. I think you can't get too focused on that one arm right there. I know she's got her tied up. She's got the neck tied up right there, but.
I would like to see Linduska have a little bit more urgency to reverse the position, or at least get back up. I think, you know, we've spent, what, 2.5, 3 minutes here now. I think she needs to have a little bit more urgency to get back up and really get back to work.
Yeah, I would say her legs are doing a tremendous job of helping her defend things, but it is that urgency. You do need explosive maneuvers as well.
Chieng trying to deliver some punches with that left hand right now.
She was a little high on the back. She's trying to adjust down. You can see she's trying to get under the neck, and you can see the way Linduska's defending.
1 minute remaining in round number two.
Again, she's high on the back. She is on the back, but she's high on the back. You can see Linduska turning the corner, trying to keep control of the arm, trying to keep control of the position so that she is not flattened out. Nice. This is actually the time to ground and pound, in my opinion.
And Chieng's only got one hook in. So if she could just switch her hips and be able to remove that hook, it's going to be a lot easier for Linduska to be able to get out of this position.
Mm-hmm. I do like the way Chieng's actually laced around that leg. It does give Linduska kind of the ability to move her hips a little bit, but it's a nice trap.
Final seconds of round number two.
Nice, that's where I would be punching.
Chieng firing a couple of shots on the way out of round number two. That round almost entirely spent on the ground. Jules, what did you make of it?
Well, I made of it that she made that straight right from Chieng in the beginning. You know, it was a really hard shot. If it did not stun, two straight rights, excuse me. Jiu-jitsu match that maybe she was expecting. You can see the face of Linduska right now. She's definitely swelling up a bit from those punches.
All right, let's take a look at some statistics through the first two rounds presented by Combat Registry. Let's have Eve Edwards take us through some of these stats.
Linduska landed more shots, but Chieng has a much higher percentage of connecting, and I think that may have this fight being even right now going into this third round.
I'm a little confused about the takedown stats because there was a takedown. But other than that, that seems like a really good assessment. Nicely done.
What a beautiful reversal by Linduska. I think going into this round, it's even. I would give the first round to Linduska. I would give the second round to Chieng due to, you know, control on the ground. I think this is this round, it's who wants it more.
You mentioned that quick reversal by Linduska as Chieng came in early to start this round.
Yeah, I mean, it's all about, like, first of all, I really appreciate, I'm going to say I love the bicep grips right there. But that reversal, yeah, she wants to put her on her back, right? She wants to get into a position where she can hit her. Now, the guard is a dangerous position to be in unless you're delivering hammers and you have good posture. And you can see Chieng's trying to set up a triangle right there. I think the elbow is free, so I think Linduska is pretty safe out of there, but Chieng's breaking the posture down. You know, she's keeping Linduska controlled, but Linduska on top is still in a position where she can deliver much harder ground and pound.
Right back in goes Linduska.
And that was a beautiful transition. As she went back in, she passed the guard. Now she's back in the guard. Chieng doing a really good job to be able to get one of those knees in to be able to re-guard. But I think Linduska, if she can control this position and minimize the submission offense of Chieng, this is a great position to be in if she could start mounting some of her own offense. She just has to be worried. She's got to be careful of those submissions. Mm-hmm.
And one of the things she's doing is she's keeping fairly good hip contact there with Chieng, making it hard for her. Like, think right now, Chieng should be thinking about inserting a hook, you know, getting to a butterfly position or getting her hips around for a submission. Oh, look, she's wrapped up that triangle, almost. I should say triangle attempt. That's not a full triangle yet. But it's a great position to be working from and actually looking for sweeps if she can get her head off the cage. If Linduska keeps her head against the cage, it's going to be a difficult position to sweep from.
Well, Linduska's now put her arm back in, but what she's doing is a really good job of stacking. Mm-hmm. She's stacking Chieng's hips on top of her head, which it is so hard to be able to create any space for a submission when your hips are over your head. It's physically impossible. So for Chieng, she needs to create space, and Linduska's doing a really good job of preventing her from doing that.
Delivering some knees now, Linduska, as we are over halfway through round number three.
And, you know, talking about that well-rounded game, those knees are super important strikes, especially, you know, from this position. There's some pretty strong, I forgot the name of the nerve ending right there at the thigh, but, man, you can really stun somebody and slow them down. Also, look at the way Linduska is pushing into the head, or she was a second ago. That's wicked. Oh, tightening up on the legs, but hard to do for Chieng because she's over the foot and not necessarily over the ankle. Loving those knees.
Not the sciatic nerve, is it? I mean, that's right in the right into the piriformis there.
I think it might be. I struggle with anatomy. I do like the way Chang's always trying to push knees into biceps. But you can see Linduska's got just such a smart counter game against jiu-jitsu. Ooh, big strike.
Some strikes with the right hand from Linduska as we hit about the 1 minute mark of round number three.
Some nice ground and pound there by Linduska, and I think this is a really great position for her to be in. I would like for her to have a little bit more offense, and for Chieng, she needs to have an urgency. She needs to not go for those submissions. Sorry, she needs to look to get up, mount some offense of her own. She's not going to be able to do it from here.
And you can see the knee split pass, almost there, not quite entirely. Chieng was able to re-guard up, and I agree. I think it's going to be hip movement. Rather than submission attempts, that'll get Chieng in a better position. There's 10 seconds left, so.
Couple more shots from Linduska. Trying to close out strong in her pro debut. Well, guys, what do we think?
You know, there was a lot of good work on the bottom from Chieng. I'm gonna say, like, that was a continually offensive jiu-jitsu attack. But I don't know how judges score that because she was getting hit while it was happening.
Yeah, and I think she was looking for submissions, but she didn't have any locked in. Mm-hmm. So while she's being active, she's still on her back. She's still being ground and pounded by Linduska, and she is in the least dominant position. So it's going to be a tough one to score, but I think, you know, I think this fight really showcased the well-roundedness of both of these ladies, and that's what both of them wanted to do stepping into the cage tonight.
And if you're wondering at home why we're not reading you the open scoring fight scores, it's because we don't actually have that information on the table right now. So if you guys see those at home, let us know. Tweet us at hashtag InvictaFC47.
All right, let's send it up now to Joe Martinez with the official decision.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and all three have it 29-28. Your winner by unanimous decision, Alyssa Lightning Linduska!
In her pro debut, Alyssa Linduska, she came in. She wanted to show her versatility. She wanted to show that fight IQ. She put it on display here tonight. Let's send it up to Eve Edwards, who's standing by with the victorious Linduska.
Thank you, Nate. I am here with your winner, Alyssa Linduska. In your pro debut, you got yourself a W. How does it feel?
I mean, I'm a perfectionist, so I wish that it was a finish, but, you know, she was tough, and, I mean, to make your pro debut on this stage against that level of competition, I mean, I'm not in here to take it easy. I expect a hard challenge, and she brought it.
You guys went into the third round. You had to dig deep. The fight was even going into the third. What are you thinking coming out for that round?
That I needed a finish, and I wanted to go for a takedown, and then she did it for me. So, you know, like, I just reversed it that way. But, you know, I wanted to work the elbows. I wanted to work all the things in training, but that's what the next competition is for.
Man, that was beautiful. So, after your win, what do you want to do next?
Is illegal in Kansas City, but and I'm gonna go back home and get back to training and get ready for the next one.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, give it up for your winner, Alyssa Linduska. See you back here in the Invicta cage soon, I hope.
Hey, use your imagination on what she wants to do tonight, ladies and gentlemen. That's none of our business, but how about that reversal? That was maybe one of the key moments in the fight. She said she wanted to go for the takedown, but it was done for her.
Yeah, it was. I mean, you know, highlights of this fight, you're seeing her. I loved this composure, and you're right. The takedown was done for her. She was able to land a very nice takedown in the first round. She definitely was stunned in the second, and then got right in there and got Chieng to the ground. And then the third round, Chieng went for that takedown, and Linduska read it. Fight IQ, Megan, you called it from the beginning. Fight IQ, what a read.
All right, so fight number one is in the books at Invicta FC 47. let's get to another big straw weight bout.
Coming up next, it's another strawweight showdown as Fatima, the Archangel Kline, faces Sid Vicious Trio. After failing to make weight for her scheduled fight at Invicta 46, the Archangel returns to Kansas City with even more focus and determination to show that her jiu-jitsu acumen is amongst the best in the division.
So I definitely expect a battle. I definitely don't plan on leaving it to the judge's decision. If you know me, you know that's never my plan. I'm looking for a first round, if anything, second round finish. She's young, she's hungry, just like I am. 2-0, you know, she's gonna come out with guns blazing, but I have my shield ready and my sword ready to conquer that.
Standing in Kline's way is a promising striker, Sid Vicious Trio. With a 2-0 professional record, Trio is looking to make a statement in her Invicta FC debut tonight.
Every single one of my fights, I go for it, and I'm not afraid to get hit. I'm not afraid to go on the ground. She wants to go on the ground, I'm not afraid. And I think that's what makes me an exciting fighter. I think that's what makes me a winner.
Coming up next, it's Fatima, the Archangel Kline, against Sid Vicious Trio.
Invicta debut for Sid Vicious Trio. Guys, she became a mother just 2 years ago via C-section. Bounced back, got her body back in shape, and she's ready to do some damage in the cage here tonight.
I don't have any children, but I know people who have had C-sections, and that is insanely impressive. That speaks to somebody who really wanted to fight. And not only that, her son was born premature, so he was in the NICU for a while. And so she had the stress of having a premature baby and the emotional and the mental stress of all of that. You know, but now her son is healthy, and she's healthy herself. She's ready to fight.
She's an Invicta fan. Her dad drove her to see Cyborg fight in Las Vegas when she was a kid.
She did, and she has been itching to get inside the Invicta cage ever since. She grew up with a fight fan, obviously, with her dad. She got into a lot of kickboxing and wrestling in high school. She didn't have her first fight until she was 18, and she has not looked back since.
The Invicta debut tonight for Sid Vicious Trillo. Jules, you and I were really excited at the idea of seeing Fatima Kline fight at Invicta FC 46. We didn't get to see it happen because she didn't make weight. But she says she has matured a lot. Her team came together after that. Their nutritionist put together a good plan. She felt like she took a step forward as a pro as a result of all that. And you know she's chomping at the bit to get back in the cage here tonight.
Not only that, she had scheduled to do a professional grappling tournament right after March, when she was supposed to be making her Invicta fight. Didn't do the fight, went into the grappling tournament, made it to the finals. I mean, kicked some serious buttage there. Really, really impressive grappling credentials on this young lady. She's a very spiritual person, and she said God had a plan. That fight didn't happen. I made adjustments, God had a plan, it's happening tonight.
Megan, after she defeated Melendez with a rear naked choke, she said, when I get a fighter on the ground, I'm a shark and they're in my ocean. But she believes she's actually expanded that ocean. She says now the cage is my ocean. She feels like she's a more complete fighter than just somebody that wants to get things to the ground right now.
Yeah, and she's so young in her career. She's only 1-0 in her career. She has so much time on her hand, and every fight she's gonna improve, every fight she's gonna get better. So I'm really excited to see what adjustments she's made since she last stepped foot in the cage.
Time now for our tale of the tape. in this strawweight fight. Sid Vicious Trillo, 22 years old, 5'3" and a 66-inch reach. Fatima Kline, 21 years old, 5'6", has the advantage in reach in this strawweight bout here tonight between these two Americans. Let's send it inside the cage to Joe Martinez.
Well, Fight fans, once again, we are set to go three rounds this in the strawweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5'3" tall, weighing in officially 114.8 pounds. In two fights, she is perfect with two victories and no defeats. Fighting out of Santa Ana, California, here is the undefeated Sid Vicious Trillo. And across the cage stands her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. She's a grappler, standing 5'6" tall, weighing at officially 116 pounds. She too stands perfect with one victory and no defeats. Fighting out of Wappingers Falls, New York, here is the Archangel, Fatima Kline. And your referee once again in charge of the action, Marcio La Selva.
Fight number two on the night. Fatima Kline, Sid Vicious Trillo. Kline in the black, Trillo in the pink. And a clash of styles here tonight, guys. And you wouldn't guess it by watching it right now, but Fatima Kline actually has an infectious smile, an effervescent personality. I mean, she was excited to be here today, but she's got a determined look on her face right now coming into this cage.
Yeah, she said the setbacks from the last fight lit a fire inside of her. Oh, beautiful takedown. Oh, my. Huge ground and pound.
Right hands from Kline, the Archangel.
She's already wrapping up, not quite on the neck, but. I like that. You can hear her coach is calling for wrist control. That's very smart right there. It gives the opportunity to strike. She's doing a really good job of putting her head over the top of Trillo's. For Trillo, she needs to have a high head to be able to get up. For Fatima Kline, by her preventing her and putting her head over Trillo's, she's stopping her from being able to posture up and be able to switch a position and get back up. So she's doing a really smart decision. And while she's doing that, it is putting her in a position to potentially take the back as well. And you can see that right leg was laced in from Fatima Kline on the top. She's kept it nice and loose and was able to slip it right through. So it was a fulcrum almost for her balance as Trillo was trying to get out.
And she's doing a really good job of riding this somewhat half guard, half knee mount position. And she's doing a really good job of, she can ride whatever Trillo does, she can control. This is a really great position for ground and pound, great position to take the back, great position to transition into mount. So I think this is a really smart move from Kline, and it's showing her evolution on the ground, that she's not just a submission artist, she's got the control, she's got the ground and pound, and she can transition and move her opponent into anywhere she wants them to go.
Absolutely, and again, I'm gonna be geeking out over that wrist control. I'm really liking the way she forces Trillo to fight for it. Oh, she's on the back now.
It's really important for Trillo to fight the hands here.
She's also got to get her hips over to the side. She can actually put some pressure if she hooks that leg. She can put some pressure on the right ankle of Fatima, but I don't think she's thinking about that right now. I think she's thinking protect the neck.
And that's what's so difficult about a body triangle.
Plus, it's stretching her out, which is so uncomfortable.
Kline got this fight on her terms right out of the gate. 2 minutes left in round number one.
Ooh, nice back elbow there from Trillo. It does open up an opportunity for the arm to be inserted. Trillo's staying very calm, in a bad position, but still fighting for the small things.
And she's doing a really good job of tucking her chin. She's keeping her chin close to her chest, close to her shoulder, and really preventing Kline from being able to position that hand where she needs to be able to get the submission.
Trillo told us she's not afraid of this thing going to the ground. She's got a chance to prove it right now.
And she is. She's showing composure. She's obviously in a tough position here. She's showing that she's, you know, defending very well. She's got composure. And, you know, if this goes to the second round, I know every fight starts standing. So it'll be time for her to potentially do what she needs to do to be able to get back in this fight.
And putting herself parallel to the cage there does give her a little bit more of an opportunity to move her hips to the side. However, it would be on the other side. Oh, you can see Fatima switching up her foot position. And Trill is trying to use the cage to push away, to climb. Still, that choke is a threat. I don't know if she's under the neck right now, but she's stretching the body out and putting a lot of pressure, not under the neck.
I would love to see Trillo reverse and switch her hips here and end up in, you know, top guard and start to do some work on her own. But Fatima is just, man, she's just so tight with her transition. She does not let you create space at all.
And again, she's wrapping up. Even if it's not under the neck, around the chin is extremely painful. Puts a lot of pressure on the neck, on the teeth.
And
break a jaw.
Damian Maia has actually had a couple of rear naked choke submission finishes from that because the pressure is so intense.
Seconds remaining in round number one. Trillo trying to deliver some shots from a tough position, closing out round number one, and there it is. Well, guys, Fatima Kline, we know she likes to get it to the ground, and she went for it right out of the gate.
She certainly did, and I mean, she wanted to showcase other skills, but she knows where her bread and butter is. She knows where her strength is. I have to say, I am impressed with Trillo. Sid Vicious shows that she's vicious at defending those attempts, those submission attempts as well. She's got some really smart awareness in there.
This takedown is just so effortless. She uses her strikes to enter into the pocket for the takedown, and that's such a high-level move. I feel like with a lot of people who are young in their amateur careers, it's very much striking, or in her early in their pro career, sorry, it's striking and then wrestling and then grappling. MMA is transitioning to who can blend it all together most effectively, and that is what Fatima Kline is showing today. Now, she's won the first round. I would like to see her strike and showcase her improvements on the feet, because she knows she's winning on the ground.
Well, we'll find out where things go here in round number two.
Sid Vicious knows she has to stay in motion or that takedown's gonna be there. She's gotta keep those feet moving and not allow a planted position that she can be taken down from. Nice right hand there from Fatima Kline. Oh, nicely
done. There's a takedown once again. This time it took 30 seconds.
And it's just effortless. She does such a phenomenal job of blending her takedowns in and hiding them behind her punches. And that is just such a high-level move. And it's so great to see somebody who is just 1-0 utilizing that type of high-level thinking in their approach to their fights.
Well, Megan, you told us as we were talking on Monday about this strawweight division in Invicta, and there's some good young talent. We're talking about a 21-year-old and a 22-year-old going to work here right now.
I mean, I hadn't even gotten to MMA at their age. I didn't start for another couple of years. So it is the talent that these ladies are at for the age that they're at is insane, and I think we're showing that tonight. And even Trillo, she might be on her back right now, but she is showing her toughness, her durability, and her, you know, defense, which is so important. I mean, it is so hard when you're coming up against somebody in Kline who is a brown belt and has competed at high level in that category. I mean, she's doing a phenomenal job for the level of competition that she's fighting right now.
Absolutely, and you can see Fatima Kline now is attacking that arm. What she does is she transitions submission attempt to submission attempt, and she has a very sophisticated leg game. Her feet are always reading, her hips are always reading the movement of her opponent. So when she attacks something with her arm, her legs are already in motion to respond. And that's not to take anything away from Sid Vicious, who is, I mean, She is fighting hard right now. It is just exhausting to be underneath somebody who is continually moving, continually making those transitions. Nicely done there.
And Kline just has an answer for everything, and that just shows the high level nature of her jiu-jitsu. Her ability to trap set in her jiu-jitsu game, as we're seeing, is she's just feeding her into the positions that she wants. Now we've seen her take in the back.
Well, I think it's as mentally exhausting for Trillo as it is physically, trying to defend yourself against all of those things.
And you can see Trillo's trying to get her feet to the cage and trying to use that as a leverage point to push off to get some hip space.
Right side punch. There you go, punch.
Kline pushing over into mount.
Ooh, big strikes.
Raining down with the right hand is Fatima, the Archangel Kline.
Oh, nicely done. She's got the head and arm locked up right there. And you can see
she's going.
Wow, nice. Go ahead.
I was going to say, she looks like she's about to sit for a guillotine potentially, but she, you know, Trillo went to her back, giving Kline the mount.
Oh, she's got the arm.
What a transition.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, look at that.
We are seeing some high-level groundwork from these two young competitors.
We certainly are. And the arm is still in there, the elbow's still in there. And Kline has a very nice leg position on that to continue to roll belly down. But you can see Trillo is using everything within her power to keep that stacked up and to prevent that roll.
I mean, we've got to give some credit to Trillo right now.
Oh, my gosh. Look at what Trillo did. Absolutely, Nate. We should.
And she's back up.
Under a minute remaining in round number two.
Now, back on their feet, but you can see Kline has that knee inserted, which can disrupt the balance and set up a trip. However, her head is buried, so reaching over the head of Trillo. Oh, back up.
Trillo has been defiant in some difficult positions through the first two rounds. She's still in this thing.
She certainly is.
Just seconds remaining in round number two.
Standing head and arm choke attempt by Kline. Difficult to pull off from right there at that angle. Oh, oh man. That transition to a double leg, guys.
Megan Jules, this is some good stuff.
Man, Fatima Kline is truly a shark on the ground. Her level and her IQ when it comes to her jiu-jitsu is insane. And just the way that she flows effortlessly, and it's like she's not even sweating. It's not like she's doing any work. She just lets her opponent make the mistakes and she capitalizes on it. But Trillo, oh my God, the heart of this young lady.
Absolutely.
She's still in it. She's getting back up and she's trying to mount her own offense in the process.
Oh, and that armbar attempt. I mean, beautiful. It looked deep to me, but Trillo stayed in motion. She read it exactly. She read the transitions that were happening. And yeah, Fatima locks up. She locks up, triangles her legs. Trillo yanks that head out, continues to roll. I mean, Trillo was in some bad spots, but she never stopped being offensive in her defense, if it makes any sense whatsoever.
Now, we're seeing some great strawweight action already, and we still have our main event coming up later, the strawweight title on the line with Ducote and Zappitella. But I'm excited we get one more round of this.
Yes, please. Oh.
Making sure both sides get the proper corners. I believe we're hearing from Judge Marcio La Silva there might have been an illegal knee.
Oh, I'd like to see the replay of that. I don't remember that. I was looking at the double leg. I didn't see an illegal knee. Interesting.
Okay. They want to see if we can get an instant replay here. I'll call out to the guys in the truck. I don't know if we have it here.
There?
At the 42nd mark or so?
I'm not a fan of this happening while the fighters are in the cage right now getting ready for their next round. I feel as though, I guess it gives them more time to rest.
40 seconds left in the round is when they believe it might have happened.
And it was from that clip? We really need to see these guys fight right now, though. I mean, they're waiting for this third round. Everybody's waiting. I would prefer that this actually instant replay happen at another time. I know that doesn't mean instant replay, but these ladies are ready to fight, and I think that's what needs to be happening right now.
And that is what's going to happen.
Good decision. All right.
Round number three. Kline, Trillo.
Trillo has a very fast hook. It hasn't quite landed yet, but I would like to see if she can get into that range. It's hard to do because Fatima Kline has some long limbs. Oh, takedown attempt from Trillo.
And Trillo drives this one to the ground this time. Kline back up to her feet, though.
All right, Sid Vicious.
Does that surprise you guys that she went for the takedown this time?
I mean, that doesn't surprise me at all. Like, that's a okay, I could also take you down. You took me down, I'm gonna take you down. That's her trying to get one back.
Absolutely, and it shows where her mindset in this fight is. She is all aggression. She has been controlled on the ground, but she's been also fighting out of everything. And you can see she's controlled against the cage a little bit. Fatima Kline was using her head to pin her. She's using her legs now. She's got that underhook. But look at the way Trillo is digging for underhooks, too. She will not have it. A lot of bounce still there in Trillo for somebody who has been defending for two rounds. It sounds like I'm being anti-Trillo, but I'm a huge fan of this.
I mean, she's still trying to find her range, and as a shorter fighter, she's going to have to double, triple up on that lead hand. She needs, and she's going to take a couple shots to get her own. And once she closes that range, she has to keep it there. She's letting Fatima reestablish that range, and then she's going to have to work to get back in again. So I would like to see her kind of double or triple up on that lead hand, get in the pocket, hit some body shots, then go back up to the head.
Oh, big right hand there.
Kline comes charging in once again and drives it into the ground.
What a fight. Again, Trillo on her back, pinned against the cage and looking for ways to hit. I love the way Fatima Kline is reading the hips right there.
We are halfway through round number three.
Nice heavy shoulder pressure there. And you can see Trillo is opening it up, using her hand to kind of open the space, and also using her feet on the cage to try to establish a better position. Yeah, and it is that knee. You can hear, I don't know if you guys can hear in the crowd, but it is that right knee of Fatima Kline that Trillo's got to be defending against. And nice hip switch there, did it. However, look at Fatima Kline is going to find a way to pass the side control.
Kline is doing a really good job of preventing Trillo from getting her underhook. And that is so important as a, you know, the person on the bottom. You need your underhook to be able to switch your hips and get back up. And Fatima is doing a really good job of shutting that down. Mm-hmm.
And I mean, this is what you do when you're pinned on the ground. You keep your body in motion like Trillo is doing. You just keep moving, you have to. It does open up possibilities for Fatima Kline to advance to a different position. And I think she might start targeting that arm in a second. Nice elbow.
1 minute remaining in round number three. Kline looking to finish off by inflicting some damage. There's a left-handed shot.
Oh,
and now raining down punches. Kline closing this fight out.
Beautiful. You can see Trillo is still moving her legs, but she's getting a lot of those shots are coming through. And Fatima's pace is also something to keep an eye on. Now Trillo's turning over. She's got the leg trapped. And Fatima wrapped right up there.
Fatima Kline just hammering down blows here in the final seconds of round number three.
It's like Donkey Kong.
Oh. And there's the stoppage. A statement from Fatima Kline, the Archangel, with a stoppage in round number three. The two young fighters absolutely battling it out here at Invicta FC 47.
And you know, you said at the top of the broadcast, Nate, there's something to prove. That's what I think everybody on this card has in common, something to prove. And I think they both proved something here tonight. Fatima Kline, dominant performance.
Kline was looking to prove that she had grown and matured from not being able to make that fight the last time around. Her team came together instead of being split apart. And boy, did she finish this fight.
Huge hammer fist, huge hammer fist. And you know, going back to Sid Vicious, I think she proved that she is no slouch.
I mean, her defensive work, Megan, when she was in trouble a couple of different times in this fight, showed what she's made of.
Oh, she really did. She showed that no matter what, she will not give up, and she will not give up looking for her own offense in the process. And I think either of these ladies shouldn't be disheartened with their performances tonight. I think they both showed tremendous heart.
All right, let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially 4 minutes, 45 seconds, round number three. Referee Marcio La Selva puts a halt to the bout. Your winner by TKO and still undefeated, Fatima, the Archangel Kline.
All right, so on the stoppage, Fatima, the Archangel Kline, gets the victory. She's now 2-0 in her Invicta career. Let's send it in to Eve Edwards with the victorious Fatima Kline.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here with your winner, Fatima Kline. Give it up for both those ladies. We need a big round of applause. It takes two warriors to give us that kind of fight. Fatima, you put in two camps basically for this fight. How does it feel to finally get in there and let loose?
It feels amazing. You know, it was a big backfire what happened last time, but honestly, God works all things out for the good of his glory. And so I just give this one to him, and through the ups and the downs, I wouldn't be here without him, so.
You went in there transitioning through positions, looking for submissions, but you had a tough opponent that wasn't giving up anything to you. What was your mindset as you're looking for these finishes?
Man, after the first few seconds of grappling with her, I was like, whoa, she's tough and strong, really strong. So I give her a lot of credit. Super tough, you know, I was definitely looking for the finish in round one and two. And, you know, during round three, I was like, man, I don't see it. But I kind of forgot about, you know, you can TKO people and you can ground and pound. So I just, you know, just transferred into that. And so I saw that there was 30 seconds left and I was willing to let it all loose. So, yeah.
Man, after that performance, I know we all want to see you back here in this Invicta cage. When can we see it, and who do you want?
Honestly, I'll take whoever. You know, I just want to get to the top. I want to fight for that belt one day. And, yeah, I'm excited to see whoever's next. And I'm always willing to grow. You know, she was a super tough opponent, so I'm looking for even tougher ones and climbing my way up to the top.
Great job tonight, Fatima. Ladies and gentlemen, your winner, Fatima Kline.
The Archangel put on a show tonight, Jules, and she came out with a statement of intent right out of the opening bell.
She did. Landing those takedowns, just really reading that beautiful double leg and that vicious ground and pound. Her transitions on the ground are just phenomenal. Sid Vicious put up some great defense. But, I mean, just the way Fatima was able to wrap up her body, take her down, I love watching this kind of all-around glory. I mean, the Donkey Kong punches and then those hammer fists just going to town, knowing that this is the last moment in the round, that she just really needed to make a statement, and she made that statement.
Well, she wants to work her way up in the strawweight division, sitting atop the strawweights in Invicta FC, Emily Ducote, getting herself ready for that main event coming up later tonight. We're just getting started here at Invicta FC 47, two fights down. We've got five more to go.
Coming up next, it's a bantamweight battle as Serena the Southpaw Outlaw DeJesus dukes it out with Brittney the Quiet Storm Cloudy. A winner of three straight fights, the most recent of those coming via decision against Lauren Mueller at Invicta 44, the defiant DeJesus says she's out to get some respect put on her name.
You look at my record, from amateurs in the beginning, all the way to now as a professional. I have never fought a can. Those girls are either on my level or a little above. For crying out loud, I fought Liz Phillips. She had 14 fights, I had four. And you know who stepped up? This girl. So there's not an ounce of me, of cowardness at all in me. I stand and I freaking fight.
In stark contrast to the boisterous DeJesus, the quiet storm, Brittney Cloudy finds her strength in calmness. When the former collegiate long jumper was presented with the opportunity to take this fight on short notice, she leapt at the chance.
My natural physical attributes have been my bread and butter. I'm long, I'm fast, I'm sharp. My footwork, my agility, my power, all of that possessed together in one is going to be very difficult to deal with, and she's going to have a task on her hands.
Coming up next, it's Serena, the Southpaw Outlaw DeJesus, versus Brittney, the Quiet Storm Cloudy.
Brittney Cloudy was a standout basketball player at one time. She was an Olympic trialist as a long jumper and triple jumper, a Golden Gloves boxer, and now an MMA fighter. And Megan, she says the third sport is going to be the charm for her. She feels this is what she was always meant to do.
Yeah, I mean, third time's the charm, definitely. But I think all of that experience helps her stepping into MMA. MMA is about endurance, but it's also about explosiveness, and all of that experience from the background in the sports that she's done coming into the cage is going to help her tremendously, and it has shown in her accolades as she has transitioned across into MMA.
Well, she has that boxing background, Jules, that she puts on display. She says everything follows the jab.
Everything follows the jab, yeah, but what's interesting is when she was talking about being a runner, she had to really work on the evenness of her gait, especially for the explosive jumps. And so learning to use her jab effectively was interesting. To concentrate on one hand, she said, was a bit difficult in the beginning.
Brittney, the Quiet Storm Cloudy, getting ready for her third Invicta fight. This, ladies and gentlemen, is a character, Serena the Southpaw Outlaw DeJesus. I mean, she came in to talk to us on Monday, throwing F-bombs out there, calling people out. She was ready to go, and she wants to make a statement here tonight.
She does, and that's one thing I love about Serena is she doesn't hold anything back. And that is the exact same way that she fights. She goes in there, she puts on a show, and the pressure that she brings is what sets her apart. She doesn't back down. I don't think I've ever seen her be in a boring fight. She is always in a war. She's always throwing hammers every time she throws. I'm excited for this one.
She said that when she gets into the cage with Cloudy, she is going to walk her the blank down. That was the way she put it when she spoke to us on Monday, Jules.
Yeah, and I believe it. I mean, that's how she fights. That's really how she approaches life. She's such an interesting individual, and she actually reminds me of some of the olden days of women's MMA where you just fought everybody. You took every fight. You went for it all the time. You accepted whatever competition was in front of you. I love that she said, you're going to put some respect on my name. Serena DeJesus has respect, in my opinion. She's got my respect. Both of these fighters do, but I mean, yeah. Serena DeJesus is definitely a name to respect in this sport.
She says, I haven't run from a single fight. I hate cardio anyway. All right, let's take a look at our tail of the tape for this bantamweight clash. Brittney Cloudy out of St. Louis, 32 years old, 5'9", has the reach advantage. DeJesus out of Las Vegas, 30 years old, 5'8", both weighing in at just over 135 pounds for this bantamweight clash. Let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
And all five fans, we are set to go with the next bout tonight. Three rounds, this in the bantamweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'9" tall, weighing in officially 135.3 pounds. In seven fights, her record stands at 4 victories with 3 defeats. Fighting out of St. Louis, Missouri, here is Brittney Quiet Storm Cloudy. And across the cage, her opponent, fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5'8" tall. She weighed in 135.6 pounds and in 6 fights, holds a record of 4 victories with 2 defeats. Fighting out of Las Vegas, Nevada, here is the Southpaw Outlaw, Serena DeJesus. And your referee in charge of the action is Nick Behrens.
Serena, the Southpaw Outlaw, dressed in the black and purple. Brittney, the Quiet Storm Cloudy, with a white top and black shorts. And we are underway. DeJesus, an outspoken advocate for the autistic community. She said she was undiagnosed until she was 13 years old. Fighting gave her a sense of peace. She said she's overstimulated by lights and loud noises. Ironically, stepping in the cage, lights and loud noises everywhere, but fighting allows her to focus on the task at hand. And the task at hand here is a quiet storm in Brittney Cloudy, who is long and athletic and likes to throw those punches.
And she's definitely doing a nice job of fitting in that jab like we were talking about. DeJesus being quite measured in this opening stanza. Big right hand. Whoa, that wasn't measured.
Looping left hand that time from DeJesus.
I am really loving what I'm seeing from Brittney Cloudy right now. She is using her jab very well as a range fighter. She's seeing how DeJesus reacts. She's using it to set up her range, set up her strike. She knows, she's feeling out her opponent right now, and I think she's doing it really well, and she's using that jab to do that.
And Megan, you asked Brittney how she was going to approach that southpaw and DeJesus, and we're seeing both of them switch their stances up a little bit so far.
Yeah, you know what was really funny is when we asked this question to both of them is they both said, well, I can switch stances too. I'm really good at the other one as well. So I think that was really, really funny. And it will be interesting to see if they do switch up for, you know, longer periods of time.
One of the things that DeJesus said her advantage will be is the open liver shot, because Cloudy will probably be circling to her left, to DeJesus' right. But I am really liking the footwork. If you're watching Cloudy's left foot, it's in and out, it's in and out, and it's always outside of the range of DeJesus.
And one thing when you are fighting in the open stance, which is, you know, orthodox versus southpaw, which we were seeing, is the person with the foot on the outside, that is the marker. The person with the foot on the outside is in a safer position because it is putting that lead shoulder in front of them. And so they're able to be a little bit more defensively sound. So I think Cloudy is doing a really good job of circling to her left away from DeJesus' power.
Clinched up here, there was a nice uppercut from Cloudy, and there was also a nice shot there from DeJesus. Nice knee from Cloudy there.
DeJesus with a right elbow. She's up against the cage right now.
Cloudy showcasing that she's got some strength in the clinch here. She's looking very solid. making some really good decisions, but she can't stay here with somebody who does have the Muay Thai background that DeJesus has.
2 minutes remaining in round number one.
I feel like that was a really big win for Cloudy, honestly. I think being able to control DeJesus and really, you know, push her up against the cage, fit in those knees, fit in those elbows, and separate and not take any damage was a huge win for her, because she just showed DeJesus that, okay, like, I'm going to take it to your world as well, and I'm going to do well.
DeJesus throws those punches. She throws them with anger.
She does, and she's a little off of that rear leg when she throws that hard kick right there, which could come into play if she's standing on one foot when she's delivering a punch. Oh, that targeting the liver. She said she really wanted to try doing that.
And that's one thing when we did speak to DeJesus earlier on in the week, she said, Cloudy's movement, she moves a lot. So as long as she cuts her off and cuts the cage down and really stalks her, she's not gonna have any issues. But I think she's still trying to figure out that timing, because Cloudy is switching stances. She's switching which direction she's moving, and she's giving up a lot of different looks, which I think is still making it hard to read for DeJesus.
Big tie up there. Jockeying for position. Cloudy has double underhooks right now. You can see DeJesus wrapping around, looking for a position. Well, she's looking for some strikes right now as Cloudy. Oh, nice elbow there from Cloudy. Oh, okay. Getting a little bit heated there with the words. So
there you go.
I think Serena's calling her out, saying she hit her. Was it the back of the head? I guess. Well, I hope we get to see the replay of that, but not at the expense of them fighting next. She's yelling now. Now, the difference here is there's a quiet storm who's absolutely not reacting emotionally, and we have DeJesus, who she's a very verbose person, very verbal. And here, looking where this elbow, yeah, it goes right behind the ear right there. DeJesus feels like that was an illegal shot.
Now, what about, is DeJesus turning her head a little bit as well? Does that come into play?
I don't know.
It looks like it touched her ear. It looked legal to me.
Well, I think that we're seeing these two personalities on display through the first round. I mean, she's the quiet storm for a reason. She told us she plays poker when she's in the cage. Meanwhile, DeJesus is coming in boisterous and angry and using emotion as we take a look at some of the stats presented by Combat Registry. Eve, what do you think?
Great footwork. I believe that the combination that she's putting together and that footwork is what's got her ahead on this card.
And round number two is underway.
One of the things we were seeing in that first round was some very nice snapping roundhouse kicks from DeJesus, not just the traditional Muay Thai kind of slam through, but oh, big, big shot.
And then a shout of aggression from DeJesus after throwing that big hand.
Yes, this is a young lady who really enjoys fighting. And that overhand, I think she's finally, yeah, she wings it so hard. And I think she's finally finding the range to get where it's gonna land effectively. She's looking for it a little bit more in the first round. Oh, takedown.
Going for the takedown.
And you can see DeJesus, she's low on the hips, is Cloudy. So you can see DeJesus is pushing on the head, and she's able to get her hips out. Nice. Nice read of the strike.
That was beautiful, beautiful defense there, switching her hips, using the head to be able to posture up and really break the posture of Cloudy. That was the big moment for DeJesus.
You can see DeJesus really looking for those big elbows in clinching situations. Also targeting the liver once again with shots across the cage. Cloudy, very composed. Very much a quiet storm.
I will say going into the second half of this second round, Cloudy's movement seems to be a little lessened.
Yes.
She's not moving as much. She's not reacting as much. And
that's where DeJesus, who is kind of this continual whirlwind, really can capitalize.
So yes, because she will keep the same pace the whole fight, and she does not stop. She's like a Terminator in the gym.
Yeah.
Cloudy up against the cage. DeJesus said, I am going to walk her down. We've seen her even more aggressive here in round number two. And whether she was right or not about an illegal shot in the first round, is she maybe using that? It seemed like that maybe flipped a switch in her, and she's fighting even more angrily here in round number two.
Yeah, some fighters, they always say don't be emotional when you fight. Some fighters' emotion's fantastic for their just the way they deliver.
One thing when we spoke to both of these ladies earlier on in the week, Nate and Julie, was that they both agree that this was going to be a war of attrition. It was going to be who can establish their game plan early and who is going to be the toughest. And we are being shown that right now.
Absolutely.
DeJesus is just relentless in that clinch.
She really is. I'm a huge underhook fan. I was going to say a different word. I am a big old fan of underhooks. But the way DeJesus, if she doesn't have an underhook, she comes over the top with an elbow. It's not always about getting the inside line. If you have the outside line, coming over and using that to strike. I really love that creativity and that diversity.
And she uses the momentum of that over elbow to feed for her own underhook. She's doing a really good job of, utilizing all of the positions that she needs to be able to establish control in that position.
1 minute remaining in round number two.
Okay, Cloudy's precision, her striking is still precise. She's still very straight punches, accurate punches. Not all of them are landing with super power. She's getting tired, clearly.
She landed a few punches there. I don't know how much power was behind them. There's an elbow from Cloudy to DeJesus. Knee from DeJesus.
I like the way DeJesus was framing on the neck right there. It was very uncomfortable. She just won't stop striking.
Final seconds of round number two. Action-packed here in round number two. DeJesus came out angrily to start that round.
Like you said, angry, big all over him. Big yell afterwards. And like I was saying, she's off of that rear leg when she's throwing, but it still delivers power. It delivers so much power. Another big left overhand there.
I think she just had to find her range, Julie. In that first round, Cloudy was moving so much that she knew that if she wanted to land that left hand, she had to throw everything and almost lunge into it. But Cloudy is now slowed down a little bit. She's not moving as much, so I think that left hand is going to be there a little bit more consistently for DeJesus without her having to lunge so much into that and really defend, put up her own defense in the process.
Combat registry providing our statistics tonight, and there is a primal scream from DeJesus as we get ready for round number three. Now there's our open scoring.
So two judges have it.
Ooh, big strike.
And one judge has both rounds to DeJesus,
Nice exchange there. Look at the way Cloudy circled out of that. She ate some shots, but you know she was able to get away. Oh, wow. I think she's reading some of these combinations. I mean, DeJesus is still landing hard, but it looks like Cloudy's getting a little pissed off herself. Not so quiet storm.
Well, she plays poker in the cage. She's showing her cards right now.
She certainly is. And DeJesus walking her down, throwing with fire.
These two bantamweights slugging it out in round number three.
And again, I'm really appreciating the shovel hooks to the liver. I do think that may have contributed to a lot of Cloudy's tiredness, the target of the liver. Look at the frame there from DeJesus on the neck. Oh, that's a rough position to be in if you're against the cage. Now, DeJesus' back is up against the cage. But Cloudy needs to be real careful of her head position there. Nice uppercut. Ooh, nicely done. There are some times when it's important to be technical, and there are some times where you just gotta effing fight.
Well, that's when DeJesus is at her best, right?
Yep. And I think Cloudy is Cloudy's getting in that zone as well. Ooh, I love that, DeJesus. She just wants to hit you everywhere.
Knees, elbows, fists flying everywhere from the Southpaw Outlaw.
Wrist control right there, very nice. Making Cloudy work for that underhook and hitting an elbow as she attempts.
Combination from Cloudy as we are halfway through round number three.
And that overhand left, you know, DeJesus, she's clubbing with it now. Oh, I love that angle. Not quite as sharp as it was. That one was.
Ooh, just the crease.
Liver shot, big liver shot. Oh, I'm sorry, Megan, go ahead.
I was gonna say, just the creativity of DeJesus is you cannot time her. She is constantly throwing different things that it makes it so hard to really counter what she's going to be throwing at you because she's so creative with her strike selection.
Mentioned DeJesus being an advocate for the autistic community. She said, I love fighting because fighting is simple. That's the way she sees it when she's in the cage.
I would not find fighting her simple. I would find it to be a complex, very difficult situation.
There's simplicity in chaos, maybe.
Yeah.
I mean, you'd hope so.
And I like the way Cloudy went into a tie clinch, tie up right there to try to create space, but it did give up the underhook. Oof. Just bracing the chin up like that. It's so demoralizing. Oh, Cloudy, nice elbows there. She's still in this fight. I know, I'm not, I think Cloudy is trying to find those perfect shots, but she's throwing with anger. She's throwing with some intensity, and she's throwing hard.
And that's what DeJesus brings, is she brings the pressure, but she brings such a high volume with the pace. And some people, it makes them sink or swim, and we are seeing Cloudy swim. She is, you know, she's meeting her. She's, you know, she's trying to mount her own offense as well. She's not going away.
No, she's controlled right now against the cage, and she has been controlled many times. But DeJesus is making her fight, which is what DeJesus does best, I think.
She makes it a brawl.
Yeah.
And she doesn't seem to have run out of gas throwing all these punches either.
No, that's what's insane.
Right?
That's what, I don't understand it when I watch Serena fight, is she just doesn't stop. She's just constantly moving, no matter how tired she is, no matter how beat up she is, she just won't stop.
10 seconds left.
And Cloudy is trying to answer strike for strike there. Not as successful, I think, in volume, but definitely still in it. Cloudy looks like she had a good time. DeJesus looks like she's at a party.
Now she went from throwing kicks and punches to dancing in the cage. DeJesus said she came here to put some respect on her name. And she took the fight to Cloudy here, and now we find out. That was a fun fight.
That was a really fun fight. You can see former Invicta fighter Helena Kalinska in her corner. DeJesus actually helped her get established from the Ukraine when she was in a bad spot and get over to America, helped her with the gym, helped her get clothing. You know, really nice to see that. And now Helena's coming off a win in the PFL. So it's great to see that camaraderie between these fighters.
Look at that smile. Serena, the Southpaw Outlaw, DeJesus, and Brittney, the Quiet Storm, Cloudy. Let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards. And the finals are 30-27, 29-28, and 29-28. All for your winner by unanimous decision, the Southpaw Outlaw, Serena DeJesus.
I'm going to have some respect put on my name one way or another, said DeJesus before this fight. And I think she wants a shot at the belt, guys. I'm not sure if you can tell that. Let's find out. Let's go into Eve Edwards standing by with the victorious DeJesus.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm here with your winner, Serena DeJesus. And I don't know if you guys are as tired as I am just by watching you fight, but you got so much energy. How are you feeling right now?
I feel fantastic. Brittney is a real motherfucker. Sorry for cursing, but that's just me. She stepped up on 3 weeks' notice. A lot of these broads will not, so Brittney deserves some respect on that. Now, in other news, I'm not asking anymore for my belt shot. I'm demanding. Me and Tennant have unfinished business. 4-fight win streak. Where's my belt?
That first round, she gave you a lot of footwork. She was giving you a lot of angles. I think some judges had her winning that first round, but you came back, kept that pressure on her. What was your mindset coming into the second round to shut her down and find your range?
I was like, oh no, she did not. And I just came after her for that. You give me a good shot, I'm gonna try and take your head off. And also, I have the best training partners in the world. I got this girl who just won on PFL, Alesha Kolesnik, beat that, you know what? I'm not gonna say another curse word, Shannon will kill me. And I got the best striking coach right here, Marvin the Beastman Eastman, UFC veteran. People better be putting respect on his name too. And I also want to thank Eric Nixick from Extreme Couture and all my teammates who helped me get ready for this fight. If it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be in here with the dub.
Well, we know you want the champion next to Jesus. When do you want that to happen?
I don't know. When do they want it to happen? I haven't seen Tennant for a year. It's weird, but I'll wait.
Ladies and gentlemen, your winner and hopefully a future title contender, Serena DeJesus.
Jules, she wants that title shot. She told us before this fight she had her eyes on Tanisha Tennant, and now she's demanding it.
Yeah, well, I mean, that is how you ask for a title shot. Not ask, you demand. Yeah, do it. Let's do it. Let's make this happen.
They definitely have unfinished business. It was a close fight between Tennant, but this one tonight really showcased why DeJesus deserves that shot. If they give it to her next, I don't know, but she showcased her creativity, her pressure, her pace is just relentless and is so hard to deal with. And I think that's gonna be a lot of problems. When we spoke to her earlier this week, when they first fought, her and Tennant, she didn't know a lot of things. She came in a short notice, she was unprepared, she was with not the best team. She believes in herself, she believes in her team, and we've seen that tonight.
Well, DeJesus wants a title shot. Alesha Zappitella has a title shot tonight, going up in weight class to take on Emily Ducote. That is tonight's main event, which is still to come.
Coming up next, it's a battle of Brazilian flyweights. as Janaisa, the evil princess Morandin, takes on Liana Pirosin. A former strawweight title challenger, Morandin is making a move up in divisions after taking a step back from fighting for the past 2 years. Now, the evil princess returns with a renewed sense of gratitude and attitude.
I think this time away from competing was more about my personal life, more about fixing my personal issues. And I took some time to take care of that and to make my mind clear, my body healthier, and to be able to give you guys a better performance.
Tonight, Morandin meets up with a former training partner of hers in fellow Brazilian Liana Pirosin, who is also making her flyweight debut. Much like Morandin, Pirosin is looking to put her extensive Muay Thai background to work this evening.
Eu e a Janaisa, a gente já treinou algumas vezes juntas lá em Curitiba. E eu conheço bastante o jogo dela, eu acredito que ela mudou, mas eu também. Então eu acredito que a gente vai dar um grande show.
Coming up next, it's Janaisa, the evil princess Morandin, versus Liana Pirosin.
Liana Pirosin, guys, has also been off for the past 2 years since her last pro fight. But she's looking to use that Muay Thai background. She said, look, I have the other parts of my MMA game intact. She's developed as a jiu-jitsu fighter, but she feels a responsibility in the Muay Thai aspect of things. That's the way she described it.
She does, and she's had 25 Muay Thai fights before she even got into MMA. She feels that whilst Janaisa is also a Muay Thai-based fighter, she's got the more experience, and she's the more well-rounded fighter coming into this fight tonight.
She's got 3 wins via knockout. Pirosin, but coming off a couple of losses, and a fairly long layoff. So we see which of these two fighters is more ready to come back here today. And they know each other well, as we heard them both saying, training against one another in years past. Liana Pirosin. Talking to Janaisa Morandin. We just heard her say that she was dealing with personal issues for the past couple of years. She suffered 3 straight losses and said those losses were affecting her mental health. It was affecting the way she viewed herself as a human being. And the time away allowed her to get back to what's important, but also realizing that it's the process of fighting that she is in love with, Jules.
It certainly, I mean, she was all smiles this week. You know, we've always, well, like in the past, we've seen her come to the shows and just kind of slip, miss weight a couple of times. You know, she was a former strawweight title contender, just never quite achieved that jump into success. But an incredible fighter, a very exciting fighter, terrific Muay Thai, and just an overall well-rounded game. And so to have her away for a couple of years and to have her kind of go on this journey of self-discovery, one thing within that is that she started teaching children, and she's finding a lot of renewed faith in working with children and understanding herself better. She said, you know, I think when I started working with kids, I understood that there was a kid in me that needed to heal a little bit too. I needed this time to myself to really touch base with myself. And you see her dancing, calm, smiling, evil princess.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like much of an evil princess when you put it in those terms, Megan, but she's been getting videos and text messages from the kids that she's been working with back in Brazil, inspiring her on in this fight tonight.
Yeah, she has, and what an incredible moment that would have to be for her. All of that hard work and the time that she puts into these kids, and just to have that, you know, support, it, particularly after the length of time she's had off, would probably have to be phenomenal for her.
All right, let's take a look at our tail of the tape for this all-Brazilian flyweight battle that is on tap for us tonight. Pirosin, 29 years old, 5'5", has a substantial reach advantage over the 27-year-old Morandin, who stands at 5 foot even with a 61-inch reach. Let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
And now, Fight fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the flyweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5 feet, 5 inches tall. Weighing in officially 126 pounds in 11 fights. Her record, 7 victories with 4 defeats. Fighting out of Curitiba, Baja, Brazil. Here is Liana Lee Pirosin. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5 feet even. She weighed in officially 125.7 pounds and in 14 fights, holds a record of 10 victories with 4 defeats. Fighting out of Coconut Creek, Florida, here is Janaisa, Evil Princess Morangin. And your referee once again in charge of the action is Nick Behrens.
Janaisa, Evil Princess Morandin versus Liana Pirosin. And we are underway. Invicta FC 47, a flyweight bout between two fighters with extensive Muay Thai backgrounds. They fought against one another, they've trained against one another. Is it going to come down to who is the best in that discipline or who can do other things?
Well, it's MMA, so it's going to be who's the best fighter at the end of the day, I think,
right?
Nate. But, you know, they're definitely going to be testing each other out Muay Thai-wise. It's been a while since they've trained together. It's been a while since, you know, they've faced each other. And I think they both understand that the other one has evolved a bit. And, you know, it's important when we're looking at Morandin, she does have 3 losses with Invicta. Her record with Invicta is not great, but those losses are to the likes of DeCoursey, Verna Changerova, Olivia Souza. Ooh.
So one thing when you do have a substantial amount of time away is finding your range in the cage and finding your timing in the cage. Training at the gym, in the training room, very different sparring than it is fighting. So I think Morandin, is finding her range a little bit more. She's having a little bit of a quick trigger. She's really starting strong. And I think Pirosin is really, finding range. She's trying to establish her range. She's playing a little bit more patient game. But I think for Janaisa, she has to close that range. She has to be aggressive with that entry. And that's what we're seeing right now.
And she's always been a little bumblebee in there. But I like, Pirosin's got a deeper stance here. She understands, that the takedowns are there. She's got to use her length. And, oh, I love that. I love the way she's flipping her kicks. And, Pirosin's being very measured. She did get caught pretty hard early on, but she seems very clear-eyed and reading the situation well. Nice knee.
And that's one thing, when you look at Pirosin, you look at a lot of the footage from her fights, her clinch, the knees are so brutal. She has such a beautiful tight clinch, and her knees are very sharp. She really strikes with the point of her knee. It's really hard to describe that over the call, but she's almost like she's stabbing her opponents with her knee, and it's so beautiful to watch.
Yeah, the kneecap's a bone, and there's some really nice ridges in it. And she's very successful at that. Oh, catch of the kick. Oh, wow. We're in Morandin all over her. You can see cruising up to her feet. Nice spin off there. Good head position there. Well, for a second.
All
And I'm liking that. Look at the way Morandin's keeping herself very, very low underneath the shoulder. I'm sorry, excuse me. Pirosin's keeping herself very low underneath Morandin, who's a smaller fighter. That's a really important thing to do when you're tall against the cage.
Yeah, both wearing all black. Morandin, the one up against the cage.
I would love it if they have worn different colors.
Nice of Pirosin, though, to put her name on the back.
Thankfully, she did, yes.
Well, there's a natural poetry to this fight, I think.
Yeah, it just rolls off the tongue, doesn't it? Morandin, Pirosin, two fighters who know one another very well. 1 minute remaining in round number one.
Oh, I really like that stutter jab. It's funny, you can see the Muay Thai coming out when they both do that hip flex. Oh, nice.
And I think one thing is really on display is both of these ladies have had close to 15 professional fights. They're showcasing their experience right now and the high-level nature of their striking is, you know, we're going from amateurs or pro debuts in our first fight. Now we're at veterans right here.
And something that's we've seen both of them do is that kind of it's not a pushing elbow, but it's definitely it's like a lead snap elbow, which favors Pirosin because of her length. It's just easy to lead that way. Really fast.
Final seconds of round number one. Invicta FC 47 is brought to you by Sunny's Wellness. Eco-friendly, sustainable CBD products. Round number one in the books here between Morandin and Pirosin. Maybe not surprising that entire round spent on their feet, Jules.
Oh, no, I think they both kind of expected that. But what I would say is we're not just seeing Muay Thai out there. We're seeing some low stances, some fakes, some nice clinch-ups. I mean, this is MMA out there with the adaptation of their high-level Muay Thai skills.
Well, for Morandin, she said she wasn't sure how this move up in weight class was going to go. I'll let you know after the fight. She would say, let's check in with Eve Edwards here. Eve, as we take a look at the statistics through round number one presented by Combat Registry.
Matt, it's showing us exactly what we're seeing, a very close, very tough technical fight. You know, both women are very close in the numbers and even on the power striking percentages. I can't wait to see what the judges have the scores at because this fight is very technical, very close, and Combat Registry is keeping us informed of everything we need to know.
What do you think, Megan? Pretty close through round number one?
Oh, it is a close fight. I am really interested to see how the judges scored this one because it was so even, like we've seen this test. Ooh, okay, Pirosin, all 10 nines from all three judges to her. I mean, I can see it.
That extensive height and reach advantage for Pirosin.
The speed with Morandin executes there. It's kind of like a tap, bam, tap, bam. Pirosin has her up against the cage now, but you can see Janaisa's changed her pace. Well, she didn't change her pace. She's always fast, but I think there's a bit of a more frenetic
energy.
She's
come out with a little bit more urgency.
Yeah.
And I think that's the beauty of having the open scoring is a fighter can adjust based on whether they know they're up or they're down on the scorecards. But one thing that Pirosin is doing a really good job is she's countering very fast. She's a really good job of just making Morandin miss, and she's countering with beautiful straight punches that are landing every single time.
So how does Morandin close that distance?
I mean, as a shorter fighter, you're going to get hit closing the range. But the thing is, you got to double, triple up on that lead hand. You got to fake those shots up top like she's doing, and she needs to go for the body and then come back up top and really hide those, you know, those little small movements as she enters into the pocket.
And I will say she's had success in catching the kicks. However, Pirosin keeps her on the edge of that because she is able to flip over the top. Oh, big shot. Oh, my goodness.
Pirosin says that she is a calculated fighter. She likes to use that first round to feel things out and then make adjustments.
I mean, it was a flying knee to an elbow right there. I'm just kind of bouncing back and forth like a rubber band. Nice hook kick.
counter for Pirosin.
And Pirosin's, you know, showing some expressiveness in there, giving a little shrug.
Yep.
Finding that opening. And it's true, Morandin is not maybe moving her feet as much as she should be here. Nice shot.
Left hand from Morandin. Now she comes in with a flurry.
I love how much they just want to hit each other.
Seen a lot of reddening on that front leg of Pirosin.
That knee stop can really prevent that straight shot to the knee right there. That can really prevent a forward attack.
How cautious do these two fighters need to be of the opposite's one-shot power right now?
Well, in my opinion, I mean, definitely cautious, but both of them are able to strike off the power shots very well. They're really good at, like, I would call it a double tap, where they strike, you strike back right away.
On the offbeat.
Yeah, offbeat. Beautiful. Oh, nice kick.
Morandin tries to answer with a kick of her own. Coming in with the left hand, Morandin.
It's staccato fighting. Nice. And I love the fakes and feints from Morandin, but I do think there's got to be, yeah. She's got to move that head just a little bit more off of those. Beautiful, beautiful Pirosin.
I think Pirosin is just, she's found her range. Mm-hmm. And look at the strike selection. It's so hard to kind of counter that because she's throwing up so many different things. And she's reading the timing of Morandin. As she enters into the pocket, she's slightly moving out of the way, and she's making her pay for that.
Mm-hmm. She's a very savvy fighter. But again, Morandin, you know, she's
standing and trading the two of them right now.
Yeah. Oh. Oh, my goodness.
A left kick from Pirosin as we're into the final seconds of round number two.
It's almost like she's in a flow state. Mm-hmm. It's just she's flowing right now. She's seeing everything, and everything is landing.
But I think Morandin's having a good time, which was really, really important to her for this fight, to have fun.
Two rounds in the books between these two Brazilian fighters. And Morandin said from a mental health standpoint, going up to this weight class was good for her. But in terms of in the cage, she's facing a size disadvantage here. And so far, guys, it seems that Pirosin has been able to use that reach advantage to her advantage.
Absolutely. I think that she is a flyweight. I think Pirosin is a flyweight. I know she's fought a flyweight before, but I think she's definitely, this is a good weight class for her. Whereas Morandin is not ineffective here. Like, she is landing hard. She is doing some damage, but she's just kind of getting outworked. Pirosin has her number in a lot of those exchanges. And sometimes, I think a stylistic change is actually what might be in store for, if you want to be in this weight class and be the shorter fighter, you're going to have to really think about getting in on the legs, getting in on that wrestling hard.
As we get ready for round number three, Megan, is Morandin going to have to change something up to try to disrupt Pirosin a little bit? And if so, what could that be?
Yeah, of course. Like Julie says, she needs to look to fit in. Clearly, what she's doing on the feet isn't working. As we go to look at the judges, how they score this round, we have two of the judges scored that last round for Pirosin, one of them scored it for Morandin. So it's kind of, you know, up in the air. But she definitely needs a finish if she wants to win this fight based on the scorecards. And I think, you know, she needs to fit in. She needs to, you know, not let Pirosin establish that range. She needs to not let Pirosin counter her as she enters in the pocket. I think having a little bit more feints, looking to take down, looking to, you know, throw a little bit higher volume with her strikes. So, you know, when she enters, she only maybe throws like a couple, you know, one or two hooks. I would want to see her throw more volume. And you know, the first couple might not land, but the next four, five, six punches might land. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and I think what's happening there, you're right, Megan. I think what's happening there is she's just a little bit too predictable now for Pirosin. Pirosin's reading her really well. She's got to change that up. Multiple, that was very nice. And I think leg kicks are good for her. Get those long legs out of your way so you can punch the face, but also getting in there. Combinations, volume combinations to get in, get her back to the mat. Easier said for me on the outside here, right? Oh, beautiful.
Right hand for Pirosin.
That fake to that overhand, lovely. Oh!
Morandin goes for the takedown.
She read a flying knee, went right into it.
First time we've seen this fight go to the ground.
This is big.
Morandin had her down briefly in the first round, but Pirosin was able to get up. So she's got to keep her down now. She's got to keep her down, I think, if she wants to win this fight. Keep her down, get a finish. It was, I guess, more of a leg grab and a trip than it was a takedown in the first. But
halfway through round number three. Megan, you told us Morandin needed to change it up. Change it up she has here in the third round.
Just call me Mystic Megan. No, Morandin definitely, she knew. She knew, she made an adjustment. And, you know, this is a great position for her as long as she stays out of, you know, any submissions.
Yeah. I was going to say, Pirosin's wrapping up that high guard.
But she did a good job. She's in half guard now, which is a really great position. If she can keep her, going for the choke. This is a beautiful position. If she can land some ground and pound, maybe take the back. This is a perfect position for Morandin, particularly when you look at the scorecards going into this last round.
One of the things that's happening, though, is that Pirosin is keeping her hips active. She's staying active. This is where Morandin needs to be. Pirosin is having none of it. She's making multiple attempts to get back to her feet, but it's that shoulder pressure right there, I think, that's really going to do a very nice job for Morandin. I think looking for that head and arm, staying pressured on the head, and making sure she keeps those hips in motion as Pirosin tries to tie her up and flip her around. I really like the way she's reading that with the knee.
One minute left in round number three, and considering what we saw from the judges, this thing could get very interesting.
Big elbow. The problem is that Morandin, she loses, not balance necessarily, but she loses dominant pressure down when she reaches up to hit. She's just kind of so small in that. She's got to strike smartly there so that she can lower those hips again. Nice.
Morandin looking to inflict some damage here.
It's kind of like
the right hand now.
And you can see, I love the way Pirosin, she controls the bicep. She's got longer arms and she's using them as much as she can from the bottom. Nicely done there by Morandin.
She's just doing a really good job of using her frames, you know, wrapping up the head, keeping low, and really being able to keep Pirosin in this position. And this is a great position and great bit of ground and pound here to finish out the round.
Mm-hmm. Well, these two Brazilians putting on a show here and making this one interesting down the stretch. As we heard, Jules, you and Megan both felt that Morandin needed to change something up in the third round. Mystic Megan over there, I mean, I don't know.
Hello.
Did we see enough for Morandin in round number three?
I think so, yes. She definitely won that round. Now, it depends on the judges. This is a very, very close fight. and I think both of them put on phenomenal performances. And what I love is that Morandin made adjustments when she knew she needed to, and that just showcases her evolution as a martial artist.
I'm excited to see how happy she is about that.
Yeah.
But again, Pirosin, really, really impressive performance today as well. You know, she was definitely on the defense that third round, but her range, her timing, I don't know, man, that flying knee to bounce back to an elbow in the second round was really something to behold.
Love seeing that big smile on the evil princess, Janaisa Morandin.
I'm so glad to have her back here. Both of them back here in America.
Yeah, yeah.
It's been too long.
2 years, too long.
That's right.
Well, let's find out what the decision is here as we send it up to Joe Martinez.
Well, fine fans, after three rounds, we go to the judges' scorecards, and here are the totals. Judge DeVilbiss has it 29-28 for Morandin. Judge Champion, 29-28, Pirosin. And Judge Kleinbeck has it 29-28 for your winner by split decision from Curitiba, Bahia, Brazil, Liana Lee Pirosin.
Decision, that shows you how close this fight was. Morandin tried to take the fight back in the third round, but in the end, it just wasn't quite enough to get the split decision.
Yeah, absolutely. I don't know, I'm excited by that fight. So far, we've seen just such equal competition, but I do think that Pirosin showed some dominance in the striking on her feet today, for sure.
All right, let's send it into the cage to Eve Edwards.
Ladies and gentlemen, here with your winner after another exciting fight. You ladies keep up in the ante, man. Coming into this one, this is an old friend of yours, old training partner. How does it feel getting this W?
Como se sente ganhando de uma ex-parceira de treino?
Para mim foi muito importante ela aceitar essa luta comigo. A gente já se conhecia dentro da academia e eu fico feliz em vencê-la e saber que eu estou no alto nível e consegui alcançar o patamar que ela estava, porque na época ela já estava lutando Invicta e eu estava lutando na cidade.
She was very happy because now she accepted the fight, and when they trained together, she was already here. So now she feels that she is in the high level too.
You ladies went back and forth, showed great head movement in there. Like, when did you figure out what you needed to do? Because you started to take the lead as this fight carried on into the second round.
Você dominou o meio, você foi dominante nos primeiros rounds. O que você acha que você tinha que fazer mais?
Eu acho que eu deveria ter mantido mais a minha distância ali no terceiro round para evitar a luta agarrada. E tenho que treinar mais e com certeza vou voltar melhor na próxima luta.
I think I have to give more distance in the third round, but I'm gonna train more and I'm gonna get better on the ground.
Nice. Now, you got your W here in Invicta. When are we gonna see you back in the cage and when can we see you back here?
Agora tem uma vitória no Invicta, quando eles vão te ver de novo aqui?
Eu espero voltar em breve, eu quero fazer pelo menos mais duas lutas esse ano.
As soon as possible, I want to fight more, two fights in this year.
Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it for Liana Pirosin.
The winner by split decision, Liana Pirosin. Both fighters putting on a show in that all-Brazilian flyweight battle. Guys, first two rounds pretty much on their feet. Third round, it was a change.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've got to really kind of see Pirosin showcase some beautiful striking in there. Not that Morandin didn't have her moments, but clearly, again, there's a, I loved watching that. But clearly, Pirosin had the upper hand here with volume, with creative angles, and just with being able to land right on the button. Now, Morandin was able to get it to the ground, and when she got it on the ground, she got hers in. She got some elbows in, but Pirosin came out the victor, and I think that was the right call.
Emily Ducote, the reigning strawweight champ, putting her belt on the line tonight against Alesha Zappitella. That is our main event. We've got two more big fights before we get to the main course.
Coming up next, it's a positively charged Atomweight bout as Lindsey Damsel VanZandt collides with Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey. After moving across the country to train with Fight Ready in Arizona, VanZandt showed that her change in scenery had paid off as she produced an impressive showing at the Phoenix tournament last June, losing out to the eventual champ Jessica Del Boni. Now VanZandt is set to take the next step in her fighting progression.
Tonight, I think I need to make a statement. I plan on finishing Hall in the first or second round. I don't think it's gonna go to the third. I wanna make a statement so that I can call out Dalbani, because she already knows we have unfinished business. And I think that belt should be around my waist. So I'm not overlooking Jillian. She's a tough girl and she's never been finished, so I'm gonna be the first to finish Hall.
Across the cage from VanZandt tonight will stand fellow New Yorker Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey. A strong grappler with a self-described grinding approach, DeCoursey has been itching to get the opportunity to demonstrate her progress since facing VanZandt several years ago as an amateur.
Lindsey and I are very familiar with each other. We fought as amateurs. It's been a few years now, but we've both evolved, we've both grown, and we're both game opponents, and I think we're gonna scrap and we're gonna put on, you know, fight of the night.
Coming up next, it's Lindsey Damsel VanZandt against Jilly Bean Lionheart DeCoursey.
Lionheart DeCoursey described her fighting style to us as a grinding style. She said, even after my wins, my face looks beat up because I use my face to grind into the opponent's jewels. She'll do whatever it takes to get a win.
Yeah, she really, really loves to fight. I mean, her love of the MMA game transcends just being in the cage. You see her active on Twitter. She watches fights all the time and talks about them. But yeah, that grinding style, like, I'm familiar with that. That was definitely a style that I had back in the day as well. Just really kind of smashing your face into things. She said she walked out of a fight knowing she'd given herself the black eye. But, you know, she's been with this organization for a while and really an asset to this organization. We saw her in the Phoenix tournament. She came up short in that tournament because she said that she wants the longer fight. One round. You know, yeah. She thought she was prepared for that, for getting a victory in one round. But, you know, she said, honestly, I'm a three-rounder, I'm a five-rounder, and I need to start finishing more.
She says she's a grappler and she knows it, Megan, but she feels she's got other aspects to her game that she can put on display here tonight as well.
Yeah, she has, when we spoke to her, she said that she's improved her striking, but she's also, you know, found so much more confidence in her ability to strike for her grappling, that is her bread and butter, that is where she does well, and she has really tailored her striking to complement that.
Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey, favorite color is orange, she's wearing orange tonight, and she's ready for a big Atomweight fight. Lindsey Damsel VanZandt made a change, guys, and moved to Arizona to switch up her training, her coaching. That led her to a really good showing in the Phoenix Tournament 4, and she believes that was just the start of kind of her renaissance as a fighter.
She looked incredible. I remember watching that card. Pretty sure we called it, Julie.
We did,
and
yeah.
She came out and shocked everyone. And she's truly right in her pre-walkout speech. She has unfinished business with Del Boni. Their last fight was a split decision. You cannot overlook Jillian DeCoursey, though. But, I mean, the changes that VanZandt has made in such a short amount of time, incredible.
It is incredible. It's you get excited when you see somebody's potential start to really blossom. And I mean, she blossomed in that tournament for us. You know, I know that she didn't get that title shot. She dropped that decision, but there was a victory there, I think, that we all saw, that we all felt on behalf of Lindsey VanZandt just from watching how beautiful her fighting was that night.
There's a mutual respect between these two fighters, and you can sense it by talking to both of them.
Yeah, and they both are very clearly respectful of each other's abilities as well. They know each other's strength, they know each other's weakness. They have watched each other fight in the 6 years that it has been since they fought as amateurs, competitors. So, you know, there's going to be some respect there.
All right, let's go to our tail of the tape for this flyweight matchup between two Americans who come from the East Coast. Jillian DeCoursey, 37 years old, 5'2", weighing in at 105.9 pounds. Damsel VanZandt, 28 years old, 5'2" as well, with a slight reach advantage, weighing in right at 106. Now let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
Well, fight fans, we are set to go with our next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the atomweight division. Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner, this mixed martial artist stands 5'2" tall, weighing in at the atomweight limit, 106 pounds in 7 fights. Her record stands at 4 victories with 3 defeats. Fighting out of Long Island, New York, here is Jilly Bean, Lionheart DeCoursey. And across the cage, her opponent, fighting out of the red corner, this mixed martial artist also stands 5'2" tall. She too weighed in 106 pounds even, and in 12 fights holds a record of 7 victories with 5 defeats. Fighting out of Scottsdale, Arizona, here is Lindsey Damsel VanZandt. And your referee in charge of the action, Marciola Selva.
In the blue corner, Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey. In the red corner, Lindsey Damsel VanZandt. A flyweight matchup here tonight at Invicta FC 47. Over the past year, Lionheart DeCoursey took to social media expressing some frustration. She wasn't getting the fight she thought she deserved. And Damsel VanZandt slid into her DMs and said, "Hang in there, girl, you're gonna get your shot." Little did she know she was the shot that DeCoursey was going to get. Now they have it here.
Great movement from both of them right now.
DeCoursey in the orange highlighted kit. VanZandt, black and green. Counterpunch from Damsel VanZandt. She said she feels so much more confident on her feet after making that switch out to Scottsdale, Arizona.
And it's one of the things we saw in the Phoenix tournament was that, oh my gosh, oh my gosh.
She is finished.
Holy moly.
Absolutely vicious from Lionheart DeCoursey. Oh.
Made a statement tonight. And you can see that we've got the medical crew talking to Lindsey VanZandt right now. She's conscious. She's getting back to her feet. Yeah, you know, we just were praising Lindsey VanZandt striking to the moon, and this is the beauty of MMA, that you can have a complete evolution. You can be incredible striker, and you can still get knocked out.
Jillian Lionheart DeCoursey, absolutely devastating in the first round, knocking out Lindsey Damsel VanZandt for the victory.
When we spoke to her, she said she's feeling like she's finally starting to put it all together. She is not just a grappler, she's not just a wrestler, she is a knockout artist, which is so rare. Do you ever see women at 105 pounds, one punch knockout like that? Never.
Looking just at this opening here. You see the right hook, excuse me, the left hook, the cross right there, and just banging right on the chin. I mean, that's a terrifying knockout when you look at it. Straight right, a hook that kind of glances but gets right in there, and then those hammer fists right at the end, pouncing right on top. Lionheart DeCoursey, yep, it was a right hand. I said right hook, my bad. Beautifully done, beautifully done.
Now at full speed.
Walked into that. She was trying to throw her own right hand, got caught. Her head was right on the center. What an absolute beautiful highlight reel for DeCoursey.
And you can just see what it means to her.
Absolutely. And you know, props to Lindsey VanZandt. I mean, this is what happens. This is fighting. It looks like her nose might be a little bit busted up there, too. Wow.
DeCoursey told us, I'm a grappler and I know it, but I've also found my comfort zone as a striker. She put that comfort zone on display here tonight at Memorial Hall. Let's send it up now to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially 1 minute, 1 second, round number one. Your winner by KO, Jilly Bean, Lionheart DeCoursey.
What a moment for DeCoursey. Let's check in with Eve Edwards standing by with the winner by knockout.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm standing here with the young powerhouse, Jillian DeCoursey. My goodness, that was beautiful. You got a message from VanZandt a few months ago telling you to hang on, you're gonna get a shot. You wanted to fight. She was rooting for you, and you're getting here to step in here with her. How's it feel?
It feels awesome. Lindsey and I are, you know, we've known each other for years. We fought as amateurs and we've stayed connected since then. You know, and it was exciting. I like to fight people that I like personally. It makes it more fun. So we always root for each other in each other's fights. So I knew, you know, she was going to be game coming in here. So I knew I had to bring my A game, and that's what I did.
You left us with very little to say, but what I want you to do for me right now, Jillian, is take us through this fight, take us through this big punch, man, please.
I've been working a lot on my striking, stepping into my punches. I have a lot of power. I just haven't been able to demonstrate it up until this point because my footwork wasn't there. So we spent pretty much the last 8 weeks working on my footwork, making sure I was stepping into my punches so the power could come out. And, you know, Atomweight's getting knockouts like that. It doesn't happen all the time, so.
Say less. That was beautiful. Ladies and gentlemen, the powerhouse.
I got something I want to say. I've been with Invicta for a really long time. I think my performance tonight earned me a shot at the title. And if Invicta and Shannon don't feel like I earned that title shot, then I want the next person that will get me that title shot.
You heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. An emphatic statement and another one at the post fight. Ladies and gentlemen, your champion, your winner, Jillian DeCoursey.
An explosive Atomweight knockout, and then a call for a title shot from.
Hello, I'm Mauro Ranallo. Welcome to the dawning of a new day in women's MMA. This is Invicta Fighting Championships 1. And Julie, tonight we pay tribute and tip the hat to those who helped pave the way for women's MMA.
Now here, a decade later, led by Shannon Knapp and Janet Martin, there's an evolution in women's mixed martial arts.
What about the mission statement for Invicta FC?
You know, Mauro, I think the mission statement here is one about equality. We're not looking to compete with the men. We're looking to establish our weight classes and fight in a cage of our own.
Coming up next, it's tonight's co-main event as two ferocious featherweights face off when Courtney the Lion King meets Chelsea Chandler. Coming off a bloodbath at the hands of Kayla Harrison at IFC 43, the Lion King is looking to prove that not only can she take a punishment, but she can dish one out as well.
Honestly, I think I have the advantage everywhere. I just think I'm a better fighter, and I think I'm just better at all of it.
Across the cage from King tonight will stand the hard-hitting Chelsea Chandler. After opening her Invicta career with a loss to Carrie Kennison, Chandler has rattled off three straight victories, winning a decision against Mitzi Mary, knocking out Brittney Victoria, and submitting Liv Parker with a rear naked choke. Now, Chandler looks to add King to her list of victims.
I think this is going to be a fight where I'm going to need to stick to my game plan, stay focused, not get overexerted in there, and lay a strategic beatdown.
Coming up next, it's tonight's co-main event, Courtney, the Lion King, against Chelsea Chandler.
Chelsea Chandler, coming off of an injury layoff, she believes that her boxing's even stronger since working her way back from that. You heard it there. She's looking for a strategic beatdown here tonight.
She might be looking for a strategic beatdown, but I will not be surprised if it is just an all-around beatdown, strategic or not, Nate. And that is what I love about watching Chelsea Chandler fight. She is so entertaining. And if her striking wasn't good enough before, I am so excited to see what it is now after some time off.
Right? You know, it's a little bit like when we saw with Serena Southpaw. This is a young lady who likes to throw a lot of punches, a lot of kicks, and she likes to get in your face.
Chelsea Chandler. It's appropriate that Courtney King loves the movie The Lion King. It's the music she wants to come out to. It's her favorite movie. It works perfectly with her name, Courtney The Lion King. She doesn't have much to say. She wants to talk with her fists in the ring, but she's tough. I mean, she will keep going no matter what happens, it seems, in this fight.
Absolutely. I mean, you know, like you described it, she'll describe it. It was a bloodbath against Kayla Harrison. And, you know, at one point she said, oh, I didn't know I was wearing lotion today. She looked down, it was her own blood. That's the kind of mindset she has where she just doesn't even know. Like, she's just in it to fight. But look how happy she is. I mean, this is a person who loves to fight. Not showing that much damage from that fight against Kayla Harrison, ready to get back in and ready to show what she's got, but she is soft-spoken. It's really hard to get her to say something or call anybody out, and it's been a good night for Lions, given Lionheart's performance earlier tonight, so she might have some confidence from that.
All right, let's go to our tail of the tape.
for this featherweight matchup. A couple of Americans duking it out. Chelsea Chandler, 31 years old, 5'8", 69-inch reach. Courtney King, 28 years old, 5'9", and a 1-inch reach advantage. Now let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
And all five fans, we are set to go with the next fight tonight. Three rounds, this in the featherweight division. Introducing you first, fighting out of the blue corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'8" tall, weighing in officially 145.8 pounds. Her record in four fights stands at 3 victories with 1 defeat. Fighting out of Stockton, California, here is Chelsea Chandler. And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist is 5'9" tall. She weighed officially 145.5 pounds and in 6 fights holds a record of 4 victories with 2 defeats. Fighting out of Fort Collins, Colorado, here is Courtney the Lion King. And your referee in charge, once again, Marcio La Selva.
Chelsea Chandler in the blue corner with the military green top and the black bottoms. And Courtney the Lion King fighting out of the red corner in the black on black. These two fighters in the featherweight division look to throw punches early. We're already seeing it. And I know, Megan, you know a thing or two about the featherweight division. You've been looking forward to this one all night.
I do. I just got really nervous. And usually when I get nervous like this, something big happens. I called it in the Dustin-Conor McGregor fight 2 when he broke his leg. I got this feeling beforehand. So I'm expecting big things. I'm a huge, huge fan of both these ladies.
This one goes to the ground early. And Jules, speaking of feelings, hey, we watched that a 10-year anniversary video, and I know that was catching you right in the feels as well. There have been so many great fights over the years, and we got another one right here.
We do. From the angle I see, she's not quite entirely under the neck, and you can see that. Gosh, I'm sorry. I got the wrong angle right there. So we have Chandler on top. She's trying to sink in that choke, and King is defending, but pretty much being smushed down. You can see the Chandler's putting her hand on her face and just like really trying to smother her down as she's in a half mount position now, looking for that head and arm choke.
Well, we found out that Shannon Knapp told all the fighters before this there'd be a $500 bonus for any fighter that finishes a fight. We just saw a dramatic finish in our last bout. These are two fighters that'll go after a finish themselves. Back up to their feet now and trading punches, Chandler and King.
They definitely just stand right in each other's range, don't they? Big overhands there from Chandler.
Chandler, in her last 3 wins, has had a submission and a knockout.
And one of the things she said about Courtney King is that Courtney King lets you tire yourself out beating her up. I don't know if that's, that's not very complimentary, but Courtney King is so tough that, you know, you can throw everything at her and just she'll just keep coming at you. Look at that trip attempt and reversal.
Yeah, that's why Chandler used that phrase strategic beatdown, right? Because she feels you can punch yourself out sometimes going after King, and she's just gonna keep coming back for more.
And King wrapping around the head, trying to get her from posturing up and delivering strikes.
Looks like a small cut has opened up over the right eye of King. And I think a couple of those elbows or those hammer fists got through a little bit, which we'll see moving forward if that's going to open up and cause some issues for her, although the blood didn't cause any issues in her last fight. I'm sure she won't notice.
Other than some slippery hands.
Really slippery, yeah. Now, Chandler is in a side mount here, isolating an arm.
And when we spoke to her this week, she felt that she had the better jiu-jitsu. She felt that she was better than King on the ground, even though King is a brown belt. She's a purple belt. And she's just looking to just dominate her everywhere. And she's looking to be set on that path right now.
And one of the things we saw, she was trying to set up a crucifix position there. She said she wanted to win by crucifix, Chelsea Chandler.
Looks like King might have some blood coming out from both temples now, or just above both eyes.
She looks like she's smiling, even when she gets clubbed on the head.
We're just seeing Chelsea Chandler bully Courtney King right now, and that's just her fighting style. She's a bully when she gets in there. She stalks her opponent, she walks them down, and she just is relentless with her pursuit of finishing her opponent.
And Chandler believes she's the class of this division right now.
Oh, yeah, she does.
Oh, I'm really enjoying her head position. You guys know I'm a sucker for head position on the cage, especially the way she can get underneath the chin and really break the posture. But King is, in these exchanges, she is fighting her own shots, right? Like, she's getting bullied, but she's still in this fight. It's a little bit hard to explain. It's like fighting Gumby a little bit. I don't mean that as an insult. It's just that she's always able to go.
And we go to round number two. See how much damage went. It looks like maybe a little coming out of the nose of Courtney the Lion King as well.
I love the swagger of Chelsea Chandler as she walks back to her corner. Her no-nonsense attitude is just, I love it. I'm a fan.
Yeah, we saw that no-nonsense attitude when we talked to her on Monday. And you can see the look on her face. Saw that open scoring in the background there, blue corner. Winning that first round, not only that's a surprise to either of you.
Absolutely not, no. That was a shutout for Chandler.
Eve, let's take a look at these stats from Combat Registry.
Yeah, they're showing us exactly what we're seeing. Chandler is just putting the pressure on. She's being first in all these exchanges and landing the biggest shots. Got the takedown and had that control from the top. And Combat Registry is keeping us right on top of all of it.
And that cut is open up the left eye of King, but she's got Chandler retreating. I mean, the opening seconds, the blood opened up above the left eye of Courtney the Lion King, but she gets the knockdown, and now both sides just absolutely trading punches.
Chandler doesn't want any more of that. It looks like there was a slip.
Okay.
Chandler was trying to recover her feet, but she turned her back. King took advantage of that. And I have to say, King's strikes look a little unorthodox. They look a little bit stiff, but they hit hard. Oh, looks like she's opened up even more now.
Blood trickling down over that left eye of Courtney the Lion King. This is a familiar refrain for her.
Yeah, I mean, it could be she learned how to use that slipperiness to her advantage. And you can see King pushing, she's got the underhook, and then Chandler was pushing against the neck, trying to get away, trying to get an opportunity to strike. Cage wrestling can be an absolutely beautiful thing, but it is a very hard area to train in. Just because it's so, I mean, grinding is probably the best word for it. It's exhausting to fight on the cage.
Chandler's doing a really good job of getting that underhook in. She's trying to look for some knees, create space, reverse the position where she has done that right there. And she's got underhooks on both sides, or at least an underhook and a bicep control. So now it's on Courtney, who is trying to create space and adjust now. But, you know, the head pressure of Chandler is really giving King some issues here.
And King is trying to get down lower, but she's standing a little bit too tall against the cage. Her legs are a little bit too close together. It's not giving her much of an opportunity to push off and use her hips to spin out. Meanwhile, Chandler's staying. Oh, just trying for a
Stay on it.
Oh. Okay. I thought he was going to check the cut.
What? I don't agree with that separation at all. I feel like both of them were moving. Both of them were looking to advance position. That was a very bizarre decision for me.
Arceo, the Silva, the referee.
And you can see, again, Chelsea Chandler's digging for that underhook. Courtney prevents it, or she reverses, gets her own underhook there. She just she lets herself get just a little bit too stiff, whereas you can see how Chandler is moving all up and down her body and dropping levels and trying to push on her hips. It's not a pretty fight. But it is a fight where, yeah.
Did we think it was going to be?
No.
Absolutely not, Nate.
But sometimes there's beauty in an ugly fight, right?
Oh, absolutely. And one of the things we are seeing from King is like those kind of those naked kicks, but she will follow a kick with a right hand, and the right hand lands. She'll do a right snap round kick, and then she'll throw a right hand right afterwards, and the right hand almost always lands. And I find that just an interesting strategy.
Those teep kicks are she's utilizing very well to stop that forward pressure of Chandler. And I think Chandler is going to have to maybe set up her strikes a little bit more, like that feint out that teep kick and then come in with her strikes.
And one of the things that the stance that Chandler has right now, she's almost kind of doing that Philly shell, like, well, not total Philly shell, I shouldn't say that, but it's comparable with the shoulder tilted down and the hands a little bit low. It turns her hip over. And if King would be able to outflank her on that side, she would probably find even more success with her right hand.
Chandler drives King back up against the cage here with less than a minute to go in round number two. That cut you're seeing on the right side of Courtney King was opened up right off the bat with a right hand by Chandler to open up round number two. She was already showing some blood at the end of round number one. They got it patched up, and boom, it opened right back up to start this round off. 30 seconds left in the round.
Chandler's just so aggressive. Like, she just really walks you down. I've voiced my opinion about wrapping around the head when you're standing tall. I feel like it's not a great strategy unless you're using it to try to push their head from the other side.
Now number two coming to a close as they go to ground. Well, Courtney King has fought through blood before. She's doing it again. And to no surprise, she's not going anywhere. But Chelsea Chandler, she said she wanted the strategic beatdown in this. Is she on her way right now?
It looks like it. I mean, obviously it kind of looked a little bit iffy there at the start, but we've cleared that up. It was a slip that caused her to kind of stumble, and she looked to recover. But she looks phenomenal. She's striking well. There's that right hand that opened up that cup. And, you know, Chandler, she's very aggressive with her strikes. I would like to see her maybe move her head off the center line a little bit more, set up her strikes, because King is doing a really good job of...
We see that slip right there. Yeah, you're right. King is doing a good job of staying on top of the moments where she can land, right?
Yes.
But that strategic approach that you're talking about, Megan, it does make for a slower paced fight in a lot of ways. Like, she's fine, she's picking her shots, she's grinding on the cage, she's looking for the opportunities. And not maybe
look at those scorecards. We have it even all across the board. So they gave that last round to King.
What's your reaction to that?
I am surprised.
Let's bring Eve Edwards in on this. Eve, what do you think of these judges' scorecards so far?
Man, I feel that Chelsea Chandler has been dominating this fight from beginning to end. I don't know what the judges have seen to score that fight for King, but possibly that slip that we saw as a slip The judges may have felt that was a knockdown, but oh man, I'm not agreeing with those scores right now.
Well, it makes for an intriguing round number three, doesn't it?
Yeah, King coming forward, initiating the clinch. And Courtney King, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu brown belt. Chelsea Chandler is a Caesar Gracie purple belt.
And that was such a smart decision. Easy takedown, look to take it to the ground. You know, when we spoke to Chelsea, she's like, she believes that Courtney King is a good, you know, off her back jiu-jitsu practitioner. So from this position, she definitely has to be a little bit cautious because she does have, you know, the rubber guard, a lot of the issues that come with that, with the triangles and the arm bars. But as long as Chandler keeps heavy over the head, avoids, you know, those legs kind of trying to wrap up around her, she should have no issues with her. I would prefer her to move to a better position that is not guard and does not give King an opportunity for those submissions. But, you know, King is doing a phenomenal job here of still utilizing her hips, throwing up those submissions and making Chandler really work for these positions.
Guys, I'm curious, knowing, you know, what the scoring is in this open scoring system, if you're Chandler, you know, has she not known the scoring, she might think or just assume she's up after the first two rounds. How does it change things knowing what the score is right now? She might be surprised like we are.
Yeah, it would make me mad. But honestly, I can't answer that. I didn't know what her relationship was with open scoring. Like, if she has her ref tell her, I'm sure she's for open scoring, but, you know, or not her ref, excuse me. The ref tells your corner man or corner person, you know, you decide whether or not you tell them. Right now, she's doing a great job of dominating and advancing her position. She was able to get, you know, to pass the guard, and the heavy pressure that she's putting on King. I think she's, again, trying to get to a crucifix position. That's where she said she really wanted to get a finish. So I think she's staying measured. That was a hard shot right there. You can see Courtney using her legs to try to block out a full pass.
King is really utilizing that knee shield very well. She's really giving Chandler some issues with her being able to pass guard with that knee shield, and it's going to help her create space to potentially get back up.
And I really actually loved that face shove that she was doing, but when you release the, it's just like a rubber band, and Chelsea read that and came right back. So you have to be real careful about doing that for too long.
Look, Chandler, I would love her to just stay in this position, work some ground and pound.
Yeah.
I feel like while she's advancing the position, I want to see her do some damage if she wants to finish out this round on top with the strikes.
I mean, she's clearly winning this round. It may be, I don't know. Yeah, I'm baffled about the second round.
King was throwing up a couple submissions early on her back, and, you know, she's still looking to move. Well, this is still dominating, I would say, like some. You'd have to agree that some ground and pound here will solidify the dominance of this position.
Absolutely.
And of this round.
You're totally right. I think she's still trying to be strategic, whereas I think now is the time for some violence.
She's got 15 seconds left to unleash some of that violence.
Nice re-guard there from King, and I think Chelsea would behoove her to bail.
Chandler's inviting her up. Well, we might have thought we knew what this decision would be, but after we saw the scores at the end of round number two, maybe there is a little intrigue here. We'll see. But Courtney King suffered some damage early, fought all the way to the end. Chandler?
I don't think Courtney King is in a fight if her face doesn't look like it has taken a beating, and I say that in the most respectful way. It's almost like she's just a magnet for her face to swell up after a fight.
I think you're right about that. You know, and she, to be fair, she was throwing in the second round. She pounced on that slip and landed some hard strikes off of it. Maybe the judges are rewarding that pounce from the Lion. Good show of respect between these two competitors. And you know, Chelsea Chandler stayed calm. She stayed strategic.
Okay, let's find out. Let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
Ladies and gentlemen, after three rounds, we go to the scorecards. All three judges see it. 29-28 for your winner by unanimous decision, Chelsea Chandler!
Chelsea Chandler came in looking to reinforce her thought that she is the class of the featherweight division right now. And she gets the unanimous decision tonight as she's standing by with Eve Edwards.
Fight fans, I have your winner here, Chelsea Chandler. Chelsea, you said you were going to come into this fight and dish out a strategic beatdown. That was systematic. What was the strategy in this one?
You know, I knew she was strong and she was really durable. She's fought some really tough opponents, so I know I had to stick to my game plan and not go in there and go crazy with her, because that's how she usually wins. The other person gets tired and then that's when she takes advantage. So second round, I feel like I was trying to kill her. And so I had to come back to the third and say, calm down, mess her up slowly. So, yeah.
Do you get the scores in the corner when you're in between rounds? And if so, how did you feel going into that third, seeing that the judges scored that second round for her?
So I knew it was a tie. I knew she probably had gotten the second, and I saw it. So I knew I had to win this. In the first round, I got her down, and I was kind of able to dominate and hold her there. So I figured third round, go out there, strike with her, and get her down, and that's what I did.
You're on a four-fight winning streak now. Tell me, what is it that Chelsea Chandler wants to see next?
Well, you know, I would ask for the Invicta belt, but I don't know if there's any other girls at 45 to fight here, you know? There's two girls in the UFC that are both fighting at 45, and I think they're both perfect matches for me, Norma Dumont and Macy. So if they can't find me someone here to fight for the title, then send me over there, because that's where I need to be, fighting regularly, not once a year.
Ladies and gentlemen, you heard it here first, Chelsea Chandler. Yeah.
Congratulations. Chelsea Chandler, a systematic beatdown is what she was going for. She knew what the score was going into round number three, and she knew she had to go win that third round.
That's such a smart decision-making on her behalf. She knew that she was able to take her down in the first round, as we see here, and dominate her. Why not go back to what worked for her earlier in the fight? And that's one of those things, when it works once, it'll work the second time, it'll work the third time if your opponent doesn't make any adjustments, and King didn't make any adjustments to that. You know, the second round was definitely all Courtney, well, not all Courtney King. I thought it was all Chelsea Chandler, but it was scored for King, and you know, Chandler had to come out and make adjustments going into that third round, and she did.
Invicta FC 47 is brought to you by Sunny's Wellness, eco-friendly, sustainable CBD products.
A new way is here, free from the time-worn, the tried, and no longer true. Beyond the foregone conclusions of past limitations, a new way is here. The challenge is now defined for and by the people. The lessons are learned and turned upon the heads of those who cling to the way it was. Driven by the promise of strength, guided by the horizon of triumph. There is a new way. We feel it in our hearts, and we move it with our muscles.
Coming up next, it's tonight's main event. The Invicta FC Strawweight Championship of the World is on the line as Emily Gordinha Ducote defends her title against Alesha Half Pint Zappitella. Ducote claimed the strawweight belt in thrilling fashion with one of the most brutal knockouts in Invicta history. a first-round stoppage of Danielle Taylor at IFC 44. It was an emotional moment for Ducote after a long and at times frustrating journey to the title. Now she's determined to make sure the belt stays in her possession.
I'm confident in all of my skills. I feel like I'm well-rounded. I've shown that before. I'm not scared to wrestle. You want to wrestle? Let's wrestle. I can wrestle offensively. I can wrestle defensively. And with that wrestling, I'll throw in the rest of my skill set. Striking, submission attempts. Wherever it goes, I feel like I'll be fully prepared and confident in myself and my skills.
Hoping to snatch that belt away from Ducote lurks Alesha Half Pint Zappitella. The former Atomweight champ is making the jump up in weight class with her eyes on the ultimate prize.
I have studied Emily since the second that that belt was put around her waist. And stylistically, I really do think that this is a good matchup for me. I've watched girls out-wrestle her, I've watched girls out-grapple her, and I have taken notes to everything that will lead to my success. And I really think that if I go in there and I put that all the work, it's gonna come out in my favor.
Coming up next, it's a showdown for the Invicta FC Strawweight Championship of the World. Emily Gordinha Ducote against Alesha Half Pint Zappitella.
Well, when you go by the name Half Pint, you might not think that you would fancy a jump up in weight class. But Alesha Zappitella says, I've always been the smaller fighter my entire life. She's not worried about going up in weight class, at least to hear her tell it, Jules.
Yeah, no, it's something she's been talking about for a while, even when she was the Atomweight champ. She wanted to be a multiple division champion. As the Atomweight champion, you know, she had a good run. As a shorter person, wrestling is the style that you really want to have going into, you know, if you're going to jump up a weight class. She's got legit strong wrestling. She's had some really terrific victories. And so it makes sense on paper. But what I really admire about her is that she decided to change her gym. She's in charge of everything with her training. She wants to become the champion, and she's going to every gym she possibly can to figure it out. She's with Sarah BJJ right now, but she said she was traveling all over the country, finding new places to train, trying to, you know, mix up her game.
Megan, she said she's been seeking out the highest level minds to help her figure out how to close the distance in fights like this.
Yeah, and as the shorter fighter, that is something that she did struggle with in the Atomweight division against those taller, particularly strikers, that they had the range control that she just wasn't able to handle. So those minds hopefully have helped her improve her striking, not just to strike, but the striking to fit in for her takedowns, which plays in her favor, obviously.
The contender tonight, Alesha Half Pint Zappitella. The strawweight champion, Emily Gordinha Ducote. And guys, she's coming off this incredible knockout of Danielle Taylor. But when we spoke with her on Monday, I got the sense she's still angry about the split decision loss she suffered the first time. She thought she should have won this title. Every great fighter maybe has a chip on their shoulder in some way or another. She seems like she's still got something to prove, even though she's the one with the title.
Oh, sure. The pundits and the fans will say you're only as good as your last fight. But a fighter doesn't think they're as good as their last fight. A fighter generally concentrates on when they were their least good in a fight because they want to improve. And I don't say that for every fighter. I'm just saying it is a mindset that you can see sometimes. They see the fights that they thought they should have won, and they hold on to that as motivation. And she's fighting a shorter wrestler like Morata.
Yep.
Again.
And she thought she deserved more credit for her takedown defense that time around, as we take a look now at our tale of the tape in this strawweight championship bout. The challenger, Alesha Zappitella, 27-year-old American, 5'11", with a 60-inch reach. And the title holder, Emily Ducote, 28 years old, 5'2", and a 4-inch reach advantage. Let's send it in to Joe Martinez.
Live from Memorial Hall here in Kansas City, Kansas. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the main event of the evening. Five rounds of action this scheduled for the Invicta FC Strawweight Championship of the World. Sanctioned by the Kansas State Athletic Commission, the interim executive director, Alejandra Prieto. The three judges scoring at cage side, Kevin Champion, Greg DeVilbiss, and Sam Kleinbeck. And when the action begins inside the cage, your referee in charge, Nick Behrens. And now, ladies and gentlemen, the judges are ready and the fighters are ready. Kansas City, make some noise if you are ready! Introducing to you first, fighting out of the blue corner. Her background is wrestling and Brazilian jiu-jitsu. At 4'11" tall, she weighed an officially 115 pounds. Her professional record stands at 9 victories, 3 defeats with 1 no contest. She fights out of Huntington, New York. Here is the former Invicta FC Atomweight champion of the world, the challenger, Alesha Zappitella! And across the cage, her opponent fighting out of the red corner. This mixed martial artist stands 5'2" tall. She weighed at officially 114 and a half pounds. In 16 fights, her record stands at 10 victories with 6 defeats, presenting the reigning, defending Invicta FC Strawweight Champion of the World from Oklahoma City, Oklahoma, Emily Gordinha.
All right, ladies, we went over the rules in the back. Let's have a good, clean fight. Obey my commands at all times. Most importantly, protect yourself at all times. Touch gloves now if you want. On my command, come out fighting.
The Invicta FC Strawweight Championship is on the line tonight at Memorial Hall in Kansas City, Kansas. Alesha Halfpint Zappitella taking on the champ, Emily Gordinha Ducote. Zappitella in the brightly colored kit, bouncing, smiling, going into this fight. Ducote, the champ, in all black, pensive and pacing as these two square off. Punches there from Ducote. I'm sorry, from Zappitella's. Ducote's got the 4-inch reach advantage, and Ducote spent all this time getting ready for this fight, figuring out the right ways to close down that distance, put her good wrestling to use.
One of the things we've seen from Ducote in the past in Invicta is just some really incredible defensive footwork and angle. She's very good at getting her head out of the way for a, you know, for a strike. She doesn't stay in one spot. So she's looking very centered right now. She's looking kind of honed in there, but she waits for an attack. She's a very good counter fighter. When she gets aggressive though, she gets real aggressive.
And one thing that's beautiful is she is patient. She doesn't feel like she needs to throw any unnecessary punches. She's waiting for that perfect moment and she hits it every time. And it's just, it's showcased with the experience that she brings to the cage.
Just briefly saw one of those counters right there.
She's very good at splitting the punch. And one of the things that Zappitella has done in the past is throw more of a looping punch, more, you know, overhands, which could play right up into Ducote's striking strength.
A hush has fallen over Memorial Hall in KCK, but you get the sense that an explosion could happen at any moment.
And, you know, I think Zappitella wants to bring out an opportunity for DeCoursey to commit to something so she can shoot.
But that's just not DeCoursey's style.
No, I know, it's
she
not.
She doesn't make any mistakes. She's so controlled and measured in her approach that she's never, you know, she's never out of balance in her footwork. She is always evenly balanced between her front and her back leg, and she never puts herself in the position to have or be counted with something.
Yeah, I think it was in the Murata fight, I might have the statistics slightly off, but I think it was 23 takedown attempts and only 6 of them were successful.
They were quick to point that out on Monday, weren't they? They wanted to talk about that fight and,
which
and,
makes
and highlight her takedown yeah. defense, yeah. It's clearly a focus coming into this one. So who makes a move first?
And that's what Zappitella was waiting for. She was waiting for DeCoursey to get into combination mode.
DeCoursey doing a very good job of stopping that takedown.
One thing Zappitella has always had a strength in is chaining takedowns. She goes from one to the next, and she will stay on your foot like there is no tomorrow if she has it. But she's fighting somebody very patient. Good head position there from Zappitella. She's a little stretched out there. When she's that stretched out, you can see she's using her shoulder and her head to really push into DeCoursey to get her off her balance so that if DeCoursey tries to shift side to side, she'll open up a takedown. But it also, her legs are very far away from her when that happens, and so she can slip quite easily herself or be reversed if she's not super cautious. Does look low.
30 seconds left. In round number one of this championship fight. Separation now.
And that space that Zappitella was giving for that spinoff had a lot to do with the way she was balanced there.
Nice right hand by the champion there.
One thing, they've both been through 5-round fights before. Oh, wow, beautiful.
Left hand landed by DeCoursey as round number one comes to a close. Feeling out process through round number one.
Yeah, and like I said, they've been through 5 rounds. Both of them have been through 5-round fights. They know what that's like. They know how to be patient. They know how to, you know.
They know they've got time. And I think that was definitely showcased, particularly by DeCoursey. She was very patient, very measured with her approach. And I think for Zappitella, it's just timing those entries. I don't see DeCoursey making the same mistake of allowing Zappitella to shoot in and get in under her hips again, though. That is just the type of fighter that DeCoursey is. She's very, very, you know, hard on herself. Not really hard on herself, but she won't let her make those same mistakes twice.
Well, I think Zappitella just got a little water up her nose right there. She started coughing.
Let's quickly, guys, take a look at the stats by Combat Registry. Eve, what do you see here? We'll check in with Eve here in a second on this as you see the stats. Go ahead, Eve.
I think Megan is absolutely right. Zappitella is trying to engage Cote and get Cote to commit to some striking. Some combinations, but Cote is just so smart and very, very patient. She's doing things absolutely right. I don't know who won that round, but it's very, very close, I think.
No one split between the judges as to who won that first round. Two of the three giving it to DeCoursey, the reigning champion.
Big left hook. Oh,
now,
right.
DeCoursey looking to do some damage with that right hand.
You can Lindsey Zappitella, she has a lot of body movement. She moves around a lot, but she doesn't move her head very much.
And that's one thing that we have seen, Julie, sorry, is that over the years is the head. It stays stationary, and as a shorter fighter, it's got to come off the center line. And that's why a lot of those bigger shots are landing. And you know, Zapatella's corner was asking for her to move her head a little bit more going into the second round.
I have to say, in that exchange, Ducote bailed on going to the ground, got back up to her feet. She's very confident here. She's seeing where that left hook can land after Zappitella, because Zappitella does drop her right hand when she wings it.
Caught Zappitella with the right hand there again. Now Zappitella tries to shoot.
Zappitella might have an issue with her right eye. She keeps closing.
Well, her left eye is now showing damage. She can't open her left eye.
Oh, my goodness, you're right. Another takedown attempt again. When she gets on a leg, she doesn't want to let go of that leg. She will hold on for dear life. I will say, though, that Ducote has some of the most vicious ground and pound in the strawweight division.
See some of that blood from the left eye of Zappitella.
The fight for wrist control becomes the fight for who gets on top, who gets the balance, who can recover. Oh, Zapatella's overreached right there in a almost Kimura. She wouldn't be Kimura'd right there, but it's not a great reach position. And she will not let go of a foot if she gets it. It's a lot of blood in that eye.
Head position, left arm.
Opening up the second round, Ducote inflicting damage with the right hand to the left eye of Zappitella.
And Zappitella trying to stay on top of her, trying to stay back. Like you can see Ducote whizzing. And Ducote's back up on her feet with that whizzer, but Zappitella still is tight on her. She's like kind of a piece of Velcro sometimes. Once she does get inside, she stays inside. Nice spin off there from Ducote.
Well, and you guys talked about the stationary head of Zappitella. If she can only see out one of those eyes, you wonder how her defense will be. On her feet now, caught another one right on the eye there.
And it looks like the medical team cage side are looking pretty closely right now at what's going on, as they should.
Shoot when she throws, Alesha. Hey! 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 Alesha.
Less than a minute remaining in round number two.
Good head pressure there from Ducote. You can see Zappitella getting inside bicep there. Oh, oh my. That was a good position to hit from.
Ducote still being patient here, though.
Absolutely. Staying on that runner, you know, that octagon within the kind of the inside. Using that as a base to find her positioning. I love that.
Final seconds of round number two. So some damage to the challenger, Zappitella. And guys, it was actually a left hand from Ducote that opened up that left eye of Zappitella. Zappitella tried to get it to the ground after that.
Ooh, that's a bad spot for a cut, you guys, a really bad spot. It looks like it's right on the eyelid.
It looks like it's right on the eyelash, like right on the edge of the lid.
Right. So they're using that, you know, they're trying to stop the blood with that. Yeah, staunch the blood with the giant Q-tips and stuff like that. But I don't know that that's going to do any good, because what's going to happen is it's going to swell. Like, there may be a medical call right here. Doesn't look like it. Zappitella says she can still see. But here's the left hand. So you see Zappitella turned her head a little bit. And when Ducote threw that hook, it just clipped right on that eye. Her hand was closed. That wasn't a finger shot, but that's leather. These gloves are leather, and leather can cut. Oh no. Okay, it looks like the doctor is the medical team's calling it. It looks like they're calling it because of... Nope, they're checking her eyes again. I'm sorry, I didn't...
She's trying to open up that left eye.
I think she's trying to convince him that she can still see. I apologize, I was given a different signal right now.
Well, you can just see the anguish on the face of Zappitella right now.
And I, they're calling it.
They're gonna have to call it. Well,
wow.
Ducote did the job here tonight.
She did.
She's defended her title. She was patient, she was pragmatic. And in the end, Zappitella.
And that's a heartbreaking way to lose.
Yeah.
It's a heartbreaking way to lose, but it's also, that's the kind of doctor stoppage that needs to happen. If it's on the eyelid like that, that it's just, it's too dangerous. That's my opinion. It's just too dangerous to keep fighting, because that will just keep swelling and that could continue to rip.
And the blood going into the eye, it's not leaking down the face, it's going right into the eye. I would rather it be stopped than have her eyesight compromised.
Absolutely.
Going forward in her career, potentially.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Zappitella was born blind, guys. I mean, she had detached retinas as a premature baby. Didn't develop eyesight till she was a few weeks old, when her retinas almost miraculously reattached. So she spoke to us about that.
That's right.
And it is, the health of the fighters has to come in as a priority at some point. All right, let's send it up to Joe Martinez.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, the end comes officially at the end of round number two. Our ringside physician calls a halt to this bout. Therefore, we declare your winner by way of TKO and still Invicta FC Strawweight Champion of the World, Emily Gordinha Ducote!
A successful title defense for Emily Gordinha Ducote. Still the strawweight champion of Invicta FC here at Invicta FC 47. She was patient.
She was. It wasn't an all-out war. Nice and patient.
Well, let's see what she has to say about it. We throw it inside the cage to Eve Edwards.
Fight fans, we're here with the champion, Emily Ducote. Emily, they say you're not truly a champion until you defend your belt. You are now truly a champion. How does it feel?
I really wanted to defend my belt. Like you said, it's kind of like, it reinforces it that you really are the champ. So I'm so happy to be able to defend my belt, get another finish, and just really enjoying this moment.
Now, you landed a big left hand that opened up the cut that eventually stopped the fight. I know you wanted more, she wanted more. How does it feel to have the fight stopped on the cut?
Yeah, I would like to finish it more myself, but, you know, Dr. Stoppage, that's fine. I knew she was going to come really heavy with the wrestling in the first and the second, so I was trying to stay a little bit smarter, a little bit sharper, keep distance a little bit better, and then pick it up kind of towards the later rounds, but I'm really excited to get the finish.
You were very patient in there. You look very good. Now, you are the true champion. You can make your call-outs. Who do you think deserves a shot at this belt?
I don't call anybody out. Shannon sends me the name, I sign the contract, and I show up here, and that's all I really care about.
Well, you've been showing up every time that I've seen you in here. Very, very proud to have been a witness to this one. I don't want to see you fight again. Congratulations, champ, and hope to see you soon. Anything for the fans?
Thank you guys so much.
Your champion, ladies and gentlemen, Emily Ducote.
Well, guys, we saw some really good strawweight talent on display here tonight throughout the course of this Invicta FC 47. Don't know who the next one's gonna be. She's not gonna call anybody out, but I feel certain she's gonna have another good challenger here coming up pretty soon.
Absolutely. You know, and in this fight, again, it's not a lackluster. It's not the excitement we wanted, but that was a precision strike. That hit hard. Eyes are, that, you know what? That's, we protect eyes. You've got to protect your eyes. And I think it was a great doctor stoppage. Just a heartbreaking loss for Zappitella. But again, DeCoursey was still just absolutely in control in that fight the entire time. Her striking was on point. She's the champion. She defended the belt. It was not the way maybe the giant knockout we wanted, but yeah, I think that she doesn't have to call people out. There's enough strawweights out there who are hungry for a chance.
You said it, Megan. This is a strawweight division. It's got some talent in it right now.
Yeah, there's a lot of amazing fighters coming up in the strawweight division, and I mean, what in a crazy night. Starting off with strawweights, we had Jennifer Chieng is taking on Alyssa Linduska, who, man, she looked phenomenal for her pro debut. Really put on a clinic and showcased that she is a true talent here in Invicta.
She showed that fight IQ, and then Fatima Kline went to work in bout number two.
Fatima Kline went to work and just absolutely showed how combat jiu-jitsu translates so well to MMA. She had a beautiful performance against a very, very game Sidney Trillo, who really defended a lot, but in the end just could not keep up with Kline.
Then Serena DeJesus against Brittney Cloudy. DeJesus, a Tasmanian devil in the cage.
It's the relentless pace that she brings is insane. The volume, the creativity, she wears herself down. And she made her call out for a title shot. She's looking at the champion right now.
A really close bout between the two Brazilians, Morandin and Pirosin.
A close bout, but definitely Pirosin's fight. It's great to have Morandin back with us and with some adjustments to her game. You know, she's still got it, guys. She's still got it. She didn't have it tonight, but you can see from her ground and pound, when she got to the ground, she was doing great stuff. Unfortunately, she did not have the reach. She did not have the striking.
The most explosive moment of the night came in the Atomweight division with Jillian DeCoursey against Lindsey VanZandt.
Oh, DeCoursey with the highlight reel knockout. It couldn't have been more perfect than that. She wanted to show that she's more than just a grappler, and she showcased that she's also a knockout artist, which you never see in the Atomweight division.
When Courtney King fights, there will be blood, and there was blood in the Featherweight division at the hands of Chelsea Chandler.
There was blood, there was strategy. It was not the high-paced fight we were expecting, but Featherweights can certainly, they can certainly hit hard, and Chandler wanted to show she can also hit hard patiently.
And then in our main event, it was a successful title defense for Emily Gordinha Ducote.
She looked incredible with that TKO stoppage. Obviously heartbreaking for Zappitella for a fight to end that way, but Ducote was patient. She picked her shot, she used control. She really showcased the talent that she brings and why she is a champion here at Invicta.
What a night here at Invicta 47. Invicta 48 coming up on July 20th for Julie Kedzie, Megan Anderson, and Eve Edwards. This is Nate Bucati saying thanks for watching from Kansas City, Kansas.